This is all very, very new to me. This whole, Oh, they're still there, Dave. Little Stembokki. Hello, gorgeous. That's a nice way to start off our pre-show, pre-live safari experience.
Pre-show show.
I quite like that. Yeah, we'll start a pre-show show with a little male Stembok. A pre-show show. This could be very, very interesting. So for those of you who are just joining us for the first time, there will be a live safari starting off in just a few moments. But we take the 5 minutes now, apparently, before the start of show to chat and be informal. And Dave's going to help me because I'm very, very rusty. I'm back from leave. And what are those animals there, Dave?
That must be an impala.
That's an impala. Well done, Dave. At least you're not rusty. Okay. I probably would have remembered the name of the impala. It's so nice coming back into the bush after about 18 days, 19 days away. Seeing how everything's changed, everything's all green. There's the impala. Sorry, impala, we can't stop for you. We've got a school drive in a moment. And I would very much like to be able to show the school children the lions that apparently are somewhere that I have to find. Now, this is all very exciting. No babies yet, Dave?
Nope.
No babies.
Yeah.
Not yet. Waiting in eager anticipation. And I'm trying to remember this time last year when the babies were born. It was, I think it was around the 12th we saw the first baby impala, Dave. So we've got 3 days and there's no woodlands kingfishers. So actually not much has changed since I left. It's about as green. It's all very exciting being back in the bush. I have really, truly missed it, and I'm going to be horribly rusty, and I might even miss a track or two, but don't tell Brent that, because he is, of course, back from leave as well, and we'll be trundling along together to bring you the live safari experience. So let's make our way towards those lions. Somehow I have the feeling that James has been singing a lot in these pre-drives. Am I right? I am right. I thought so. Opera. I do feel like I've missed out. Is that terrible fear of missing out when you go on leave? No, Kirsty, I don't think I'm going to. Definitely not going to be singing opera. That is not going to happen. I am not going to be singing in my finest soprano voice because I don't have a finest soprano voice. In fact, the camera might shatter. Hit that high note, high G or something, and the camera lens will just go. And that would be that for the safari. That would be most tragic. Can you sing opera, Dave? Oh, Thank you, Kirst. The schools will be joining us at some point, for those of you who are with us on our pre-show show. We will wait with eager anticipation that they have jumped on board with us as well. Yeah, no, I'm not going to be singing any opera. Opera's not my... I've got very, very broad music tastes. Opera doesn't... I'm not so sure about opera falling in there, especially soprano stuff. The deep bass and tenor I can handle, but... More impalas! Excuse me. Hello. It's going to be very interesting to see what sort of effect the drought has on the births this year. Yeah. There's a couple of very pregnant looking ewes. I hope you're all excited, doing your countdowns. Perhaps for some of you, allowing the live safaris to transport you outside worldly wide affairs. I'm excited. Going to go and see how big the Nkuhuma cubs have got. Have they got big, Dave?
Oh, yes.
I'm so excited. I saw the clip of them hunting the buffalo. Well, hunting is a very strong term. But jumping on the back of the baby buffalo. Hello, wildy beasts. Goodness, there's all animals on Buffalo's boundary today. Hello, hello. Also very pregnant.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to the middle of the African bush. This is the Sabi Sands, and those are some warthogs, and this is Safari Live. Welcome to a wonderfully green Juma private game reserve since I was last here. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have my very good friend and fellow partner in crime, Brian Joubert, the thumb as well there. It's a very green thumb, and that's quite apt since we're in a wonderful green setting as summer sets in here in the African bushveld. But just for those of you who might not know, who've only joined us in the last couple of weeks that I have not been here, when Brian and I get together, we are known as the Killer Bees. And that's because we find all the killer sightings. Now, a little birdie, actually it wasn't a little birdie, it was my good friend Ryan, has told me that after morning drive this morning, there were apparently some wild dogs heading in this direction. Now, wild dogs are my favorite animals, so I'm going to go see if we can find their footprints, or even better, find the puppies snoozing in the shade. There's also a report of a female leopard right up in the sort of northwestern corner, coming through from Siwambili into Juba, so we're definitely going to go have a look. Ooh, and one of the things I do love about summer is the birding, and this is not one of our migrants and vagrants who comes to visit us. This is one of the birds we have all year round, and it is still absolutely magnificent. And just because I think you guys have not been being tested, I don't know if people have been keeping up your knowledge while I've been away, it's quiz time. And what bird is that? Now have a look, a very distinct head shape and a very bright orange eye, and that is the diagnostic feature. Now remember, this is live, so I want you to tell me live what bird this is, and you can do that by emailing questions at wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Oh, and looking a bit bedraggled, probably molting, getting rid of some of that winter warmth, that winter fluff, as we get into the proper heat of the African summer. It's 92 Fahrenheit today, 33 Celsius, but relatively humid, Brian, wouldn't you say? And it's almost like there's a storm in the air. Hopefully it'll come and deluge on us, but after the live safari, of course. So we're going to keep making our way towards Impala Plains, where the rumour of the African painted wolf and their tracks coming across will be. Now, of course, I'm sure there's been a lot of discussion about when will be the first Impala lamb. If I remember correctly, and if you guys want to remind me, I think it was the 13th of November last year, and it was the killer bees who saw it. So will the killer bees be the first to find an Impala lamb this year? But there's some Impalas there, all looking quite preggers. But the other thing is, I think we might find there's quite a few stillborn lambs this year. Even though it has rained, it has been the driest year on record, so since 1902, and coming up ahead are some of the animals that have really suffered during this drought. And if with them suffering, it has made an incredible Nkuhumas have been kept fat and happy. And here we go, there's a little herd of African buffalo or Cape buffalo, and very exciting, we have a school drive. Yay, welcome guys. Glenwood and Windsor Oaks in Virginia Beach are joining us. So looking forward to having you on our live drive. I'm just gonna go a bit forward. I think there's a few more buffalo around the corner. Now, it's amazing. They're already picking up conditions since I was last here with a little bit of green flush. They're by no means in great nick. Funny looking. Oh yeah, a little buffalo cow. Okay, let's have a look. There seem to be a few more around the corner. Maybe we'll get lucky enough to see a big daddy buffalo with that massive horns, and we're going to show you the difference between the male and female buffalo, because it's quite easy when you know what to look for. So for those of you who are guessing about that eagle, you are spot on correct. Those who said the brown snake eagle, that incredibly wonderful orange eyes, very diagnostic feature, also the very upright body position. Okay, hello buffaloes. We've got a little juvenile in front of us. Oh, brave juvenile giving us playing chicken. He won. We had to stop. Hey, little one. So even though it might look like a cow, and they are quite separate genetically from cows that we know, that we farm, and they split a couple of million years ago. Very important animal in the bush. Not only is it a big mobile lawnmower, it's also a mobile fertilizing machine. Especially nice big herds. This looks to be quite a sizable herd. They're quite spread out though. Always look carefully when you're looking at buffalo for a very cool bird called an oxpecker. And what he does is he eats any ticks and other parasites that might be on the buffalo. I'm not seeing any here. Thought I heard one. Let's go forward a little bit. Let's see if we win the chicken game. But now, guys, there at school, isn't this amazing? You're going on a live African safari while you're in your classroom. So please send me as many questions as possible. I'd love to hear from you. Ooh, buffaloes, buffaloes everywhere. We're surrounded. Okay, so I'm looking for some wild dogs and maybe a leopard. So we're going to leave these buffaloes for now. While we do that, I'm not the only person driving around the bush trying to find all the incredible creatures for you. So let's go meet Jamie.
Hello, hello, and a very special and warm welcome to all of the kids at Glenwood Elementary and Windsor Oaks Primary School. It is lovely to have you all on board. My name is Jamie, and behind me sits a gentleman called Dave. Now, Dave's quite shy, aren't you, Dave?
Yes, I am.
Very shy. So probably all you're ever going to see of Dave is his hand, but what's happening is happening right here in real life on a place called Juma Private Game Reserve, which is right in South Africa. Now, on a hot afternoon, because bear in mind, we're in the middle of summer here in South Africa. A hot afternoon like this afternoon where it is 92 degrees Fahrenheit here. It's always a really very good idea to come through to the waterhole to see what we can see. And let's see what is at a waterhole called Buffalo's Hook. Oh, I see one thing already. Here we go. This is my first time visiting Buffalo's Hook Dam, or Buffalo's Hook Waterhole, in almost 2 weeks. And look at all of that, and look who's here. What do you think that is? That, lying off in the distance, is a hippopotamus. And it's not just a hippopotamus, but look at that. He's got two very cheeky, what we call terrapins. So they're not turtles, they're terrapins, and they are sitting on the back of the hippopotamus, just enjoying some time to warm up after their swim. Now, there you go, one stretching. Everybody wave to the terrapin. Look, it's waving at you. The one at the back's waving. Everybody wave back to the terrapin. So, Timothy and Tina, the terrapins, are using the hippopotamus to just have a break from their swim. Catherine, if we take a bit of a further look, you wanted to know what is one of the most common animals that we see. And if we look on the opposite side of Buffalo's Hook Dam, we've got a herd of what's known as impala, which is a type of antelope. Now, an impala is hands down the most numerous antelope that we get in this particular area. There are thousands and thousands of them in this particular spot. So bear in mind, we're driving around in a wilderness area that is bigger than some of the small countries in the world, so bigger even than the country of Wales in the United Kingdom. This is the animal that we probably, at least the male, the mammal, that we see most commonly. And what's amazing about this is very, very soon, all of the Impala females are going to start giving birth, so there's going to be even more little Impala wandering around. So that's the animal we probably see the most of in terms of mammals. We also see lots and lots of birds, and to be honest, the animal that we probably see the most of is a fly. I see there's a few of them flying around Dave at the moment on these hot and sweaty afternoons. There's always some of them buzzing around and about, so there's definitely... I've had a few of them fly into my mouth before while I'm talking, so now I'm nervous because it's happened once before. Now, that's probably the insect that we see the most of. And mosquitoes. Lots and lots of mosquitoes. And Shannon, you wanted to know, while we talk about animals that we see lots of, you wanted to know if we're going to see any cheetahs. Well, Shannon, this is the joy of the live safari, is that I never know what we're going to see, especially because I've been away on holiday for 2 weeks. So there could be cheetah around the very next corner, and I would have absolutely no idea. So we'll keep our fingers crossed for cheetah, because we could see them here. We're also keeping our fingers crossed for leopard. And I hear a report, because I have my sources. And of course, whenever I come back from a holiday, I always talk to everybody and find out where all of the animals are. I hear that there might even be lions somewhere around here. So that's what we're going to do today, is you're going to help me go and look while Brent looks for those wild dogs. You're going to help me look for those lions. Let's take one last look at that hippopotamus, because they are fascinating animals, and I don't want to rush off just yet. I want to talk a little bit more about this hippo. Now, at the moment, although you can see lots of water here, South Africa's... Oh, look at the terrapin! It is yawning. I'm not sure if you saw that, but the terrapin obviously finds me very boring. Sorry, terrapin. I'm sorry, Timothy. Am I very boring? Anyway, what I was going to talk about was the fact that South Africa's actually had a terrible time with rainfall. So we're in the middle of a terrible, terrible drought. And that means that for animals like the hippopotamus, life is particularly tough. Means that they've got to try and find during the day with their sensitive skin water that is deep enough that they can actually hide away from the harsh African sun when temperatures here can get well over 100 degrees Fahrenheit. You can see that this dam that this hippo's in isn't quite deep enough to cover him. Look at the bubbles. Look carefully where the hippo's ear at the back. Can see the bubbles coming up. That's him breathing out a little bit. So that's coming from the hippopotamus. And he can't breathe underwater, he's just breathing out a little bit. And every 5 minutes or so, he's going to have to lift his head up and take a deep breath of air. It's roughly every 5 minutes. And he looks big and slow, but these animals are actually amazingly powerful. Oh, look, our terrapin's having another stretch. Remember I said it's not a turtle, it's a terrapin. And that's because a turtle only lives in water. So it only ever swims and it only comes out onto land when it's time to lay eggs. Whereas a terrapin spends most of its time in the water, but it can also walk on land. So it's kind of got this weird combination between flippers and feet that you saw waving at you earlier. Oh, look at that. Amazing, the sandpipers are back. Here we go. Lovely little bird digging in the mud, looking for whatever it can find. Now, while we've seen this little sandpiper digging using its probing beak, Daniel, you wanted to know, to go back through to the hippo. You wanted to know whether or not, or how fast a hippo can go. Nathan's question. Nathan, you wanted to know how fast a hippo can go. And the answer is very, very fast. So it's important to remember that as human beings with our two puny legs, we can't outrun anything here. And although a hippo has short legs and a big fat body, and they really do have quite big fat bodies, they weigh over 4,000 pounds, they can still cover. Now imagine this. I want you to try, when you go outside after this live safari, to trace out 13 big steps. So 13 meters, or the equivalent of 13 meters, and they can cover that in 1 second. That's how fast they can run. So close to, I would say about 40 feet per second that they can run when they really want to. And I've been chased by a hippo before. I know just how fast they can move. And they can run up and they can run down. They might not be able to jump, but they can certainly run up a hill and down a hill. This terrapin looks like it's about to slide off the back of the hippopotamus. Now, usually on a normal summer's day with lots of rain, this dam would be full of water. This water would be full. And we'd see lots and lots of hippopotamus in it. And Greta, you wanted to know if hippo are territorial. Usually not too badly. So what will happen is you'll get a pod of hippos, females. There'll usually be one or two big males in a big section of water. But they will, the big dominant males will go and mark out a territory. But in a situation like this where there's hardly any water, you'll find that the hippo are far grumpier than normal. And in fact, they fight a lot more. It's not uncommon to see them with injuries, with scratches on their backs, with holes in them, from fighting with other hippopotamus, just because they're so stressed by the lack of space and the lack of water that's around, that they get cross with each other and even cross with other animals. And we've seen many times hippo often running forward to chase other animals away when they come and try and drink. And that's not their fault. It's because they're scared, they're stressed, and they're very, very hot. He seems quite peaceful now, though. A hippo always feels more comfortable in water. Oh, talking about hippopotamus, often they... I'm just laughing at the geese are making such a noise at each other. Calling to each other. You might have geese where you are. Perhaps not this type, though. This is an Egyptian goose. Sorry, Corby, while we look along the water's edge and we look at these geese, you wanted to know if we have crocodiles here. And the answer is yes, absolutely we could. Crocodiles can walk long distances on land, and whilst I haven't seen a crocodile in this dam before, or in this waterhole before, I would say it's entirely possible that there could be one. Look at them, they're thirsty. They're drinking. The male at the back and the female in the front. A pair of Egyptian geese. So yes, we do get lots of crocodile in the Greater Kruger National Park area. There's not too many at the moment because of the drought. Making quack, quack, quacking noises. Beautiful. This is why we always come through to a waterhole on a hot afternoon to see what we can find in the shade of a big tree. Right, well, we've spent, I think, enough time at the waterhole. I think it's time for us to go and look for those lions. So while I go and search for those lions, let's jump on board with Brent and find out how his search for wild dogs is going.
So we found their footprints, but they're heading straight north. We're gonna keep checking where they go. I do have a sneaky suspicion they might leave our traverse area, and if that's the case, we're gonna go look for some leopard. Hopefully, fingers crossed, we're gonna find one or both. So I'm very excited. It's my first drive back in the bush. So hi, Devon. Devon would like to know, what is the most rare animal we see? That's a really good question. So African wild dogs, although we see them quite regularly, they are one of the rarest animals on earth. Now, as dog species go, because they are part of the big dog family, the canid family, there's only 3,500 wild dogs left in the whole of the world. So they're very rare. Probably after that, there's lots of little things that aren't so rare in terms of their numbers, but they're rare to see, like aardvark, which basically means an earth pig, and he eats termites, or a scaly anteater, which is a pangolin, which is like a big version of an armadillo with plates on there. Okay, let's see. So one of the way we find animals is to look at the footprints. So this is exactly what we're going to do. And sometimes it can be quite difficult. Hi, Catherine. Catherine would like to know what my favorite animal is. Well, Catherine, it's the wild dog, because they're just so exciting. They are very, very mobile. I'm going to try to see if I can find you a clear footprint of one. They might have cut through the bush here, so we're going to loop around ahead. So Catherine, the reason I like wild dogs so much is because they've got a really, really... What is that down there, Brian? It is a stump!
Oh, wonderful.
A stump. So quite often while you're driving through the bush, we think we spot something. But we see lots of tree lions and leopard bushes and wild dog stumps or sticks. But it's always worth checking everyone, because maybe one in 20 times it's a leopard or a lion or a wild dog. Sorry about that, Catherine. So as I was saying, they've got really incredible social structures. So they're a very social animal, and they hunt as a unit, and they're really difficult to keep up with. I think that's maybe why I like them, because it's a big challenge, because they move very quickly. Brian's much better at maths than I am, so 60 kilometers an hour in miles, Brian? No, other way around. 60 kilometers an hour must be about 30 miles. 30 miles an hour. Now they can do 30 miles an hour for running, remember, for about 8 miles, 9 miles. They can just keep it going. So quite often that's how they catch their prey. They just run until the animals are really tired. They are what you call coursing predators. So they're not stalking predators like a lion or leopard that sneaks up to things and sneak up to things. Wild dogs will just run through and chase things. Now Sam's wondering, are they loose dogs? They are not at all, Sam. So they separated from dogs about 1.4 million years ago. They've got different types of teeth. They've got teeth that are capable of cutting and ripping, whereas dogs have got teeth for holding. They also have an extra toe that normal dogs don't have, and they look color-wise very different to dog. So the scientific name for a wild dog is a Lycanpictus, which means painted wolf. They're wonderful splotchy colors. I don't have a picture of them with me, but hopefully we won't have to show you a picture. We'll find one live. And while we do keep searching for the African wild dog, Jamie has got the tallest mammal in the world.
I haven't found the lions just yet, but as Brent says, I have got the tallest mammal in the world. And what a spectacular animal it is. And look what he's doing. He's scratching his head on the tree, rubbing it up and down. Now, when you're a giraffe and you don't have thumbs, but you do have lots of ectoparasites called ticks making you itchy, there's nothing like having a jolly good scratch against a tree. Don't go. Don't disappear, mister. It's a massive bull giraffe, or a male giraffe. Isn't he beautiful? In the prime of his life, well over, I would say, at least 15 feet tall. It's amazing how such a big animal can disappear. Don't go. Oh no, I think he's going to vanish from us. He's disappeared behind the trees. This is devastating, Dave. Got him. Yeah, there we go. Ha ha! A big male giraffe. Look, something's happened to his ear. There's a little funny piece out of it. He's scratched it, or it's become infected. Now, from that vantage point, that giraffe can see far into the bushes. And for the most part, there's not much out here that's capable of hunting giraffe except a pride of lions, which is exactly what we were looking for. Now, I would love to stay and talk a little bit more about this giraffe, but he is walking away, and I've only got limited time to spend with you, and I'm sure you all really, really want to see some lions. But come with me, let's go. Apparently, they're just up ahead of us on the road. Now there's a difficult question, because Amaya would like to know what is the smallest animal that we get out here. Well, because animals are such a broad heading, that includes insects and things, and of course we get things like mosquitoes and tiny, tiny little microscopic insects. But if we talk about mammals, one of the smallest mammals we get is something called a bushveld gerbil, which is a type of mouse almost. It's a rodent. It's a type of rodent. We also get things called elephant shrews. Now, when you're finished with this, you should have a look and see what an elephant shrew looks like. It's like a little mouse, but it's got a really long nose, which is so, so cute. And that's obviously where it gets its name from, because an elephant has a big swinging trunk in front of its face. So that's where the elephant shrew gets its name from. So those are some of the small mammals that we see, but we also get things like frogs. There's a frog actually that lives in my cupboard, and I've just noticed that that frog is still living in my cupboard, even though I've been away for 2 weeks. the frog stays there. So we get frogs, we get fishes living in the dams, we get all sorts of things. And yes, Greta, we do indeed. And in fact, that is why I was so happy to find that frog in my cupboard today after being away for 2 weeks, because it meant that there probably aren't any snakes living in my clothes that I left behind. Do you want to know if we get snakes? We do get snakes, lots of different types. Snakes are actually one of my favorite animals. Now, hands up if you're afraid of a snake, if you think snakes are really, really scary. And that's a good thing in a way. It's right to be cautious of snakes because they're... Hello, kudu. Here's another beautiful antelope. Sorry, let me just... I know we're looking at these beautiful creatures. It's called a kudu. K-U-D-U, kudu. That's a young male. You can see his horns growing up there. But let me just finish off chatting about snakes quickly, because we did start talking about it, and it's important. It's important to remember that snakes are more afraid of you than you are of them, and they're actually really fascinating creatures. They're just as interesting as these beautiful kudu, and whilst it's okay to be a little bit scared of them, it's always important to remember that we should respect them as much as we'd respect an antelope, just like these beautiful creatures. Okay, come. I know there's kudu, there's just so much to look at, but I'm sure you want to see the lions. And we better race forward. Oh, Evan, you've asked me that really difficult question. You want to know what my favorite animal is. And it's really, really hard to choose, Evan. I find it particularly difficult, and it kind of depends on the mood that I'm in. But to be honest, Evan, one of my favorite animals is a rhinoceros, and in particular, a black rhino. I find them absolutely amazing animals. They're actually officially known as the hook-lipped rhino, because they've got a kind of, their top lip is a hook. Like that. And it hooks around the leaves of the trees that they eat. Then I also really like spending time with elephants, and I also really love spotted hyena, but it's so hard to choose, Evan. I couldn't begin to tell you. Dave, do you have a favorite animal? It's difficult. It is difficult, isn't it? An elephant. Elephants are magic. They are so intelligent. Evan, what's your favorite animal? What's your favorite animal that you like of all of the different animals out here? Because, of course, I'm just talking about African animals, but there's things like dolphins and whales, wolves, bears. I've never seen a bear, and I really want to. Right. The lions apparently were somewhere here. Help me look. We're looking for a flash of tawny, that brown color. Everybody help me look for those animals. They've got to be somewhere here. Now, Maya, you wanted to know, what is a dangerous animal out here? Dave, either this way or that way?
This way,
good. Maya, you want to know what's dangerous? Well, all wild animals are potentially dangerous. And it's really important to remember that we live in their home and not the other way around. And so what that means is that we've got to be very, very respectful of the different animals that we get out here. Elephants can be dangerous. They're much, much bigger, much heavier than us. Lions can be dangerous. They're obviously predators, but then again, they're far more afraid of us during the day than we are of them. But everything has the potential to be dangerous because everything just wants to survive. It just wants to live. And we've just got to make sure that we don't impact the animals in any way and that we're very respectful, because nothing out here wants to kill us. Nothing out here wants to hurt us. It's just a matter of us living in their home and giving them the respect that they deserve. Where are these lions? I heard tell that they were lying up somewhere in the road, which is exciting stuff. Let's go a little bit faster, because I know that you're reaching the end of your class. I don't want you to miss out. Sam, talking of the different animals that we get to see, you want to know if we get hares in South Africa. I'm going to guess and say they're right here. And the answer is yes, absolutely, we do get hares. Right. I hope you're all... Oh, bears. Sorry, was it bears or hares? Is it bears? We definitely don't get bears in South Africa. Not hares, bears. No, we don't get bears in South Africa. We do get vultures. And with vultures, often is a kill. And in front of us, I think we have finally found the lions. I hope you're all very excited. See if you can spot them. This is a whole pride of lions. They even have little babies with them. I hope you're very, very excited. Ah, this is wonderful. So here's where it's important. Remember what we were talking about with respect and the fact that the animals are dangerous? I'm going to be very, very cautious, make sure that I'm going nice and slowly, watching them all of the time to make sure that I'm not scaring them in any way. Hello, gorgeous. Look at that. A whole pride of lions lying up in the shade. And what beautiful creatures they are. Isn't this exciting? Well, we might not have found the cheetah that you asked about earlier, but we have found one. Ooh, how many lions do you think you can count? Here's one, two, three, four. Look at that. Tiny little baby at the back there. Now, I happen to know that this particular pride of lions has eight little babies with them. So eight little lion cubs. There's one there, hiding behind the tree. Look how fast they're breathing. They're very, very hot, so they're actually panting. The rest of them are clever little creatures. They're hiding in the back, underneath the branches of the trees. Nice, thick green tree to give them shade. Now, a lion can't sweat like you and I can, so in order to cool themselves down, just like your dogs and cats, well, more your dogs might do, actually, they have to pant in order to cool down. And that's what they're doing at the moment. There you can see she's breathing, panting. Now, these are truly spectacular animals, and it's hard for you to tell just how big they really are. And I can tell you that they are much, much bigger than your average house cat. Maybe some of you have seen a lion before in a zoo, but these are truly wild lions, and these females probably weigh close to 300 pounds in terms of weight. So they are absolutely massive. Pure muscle. Look at that fierce, intent gaze. Look, she's looking up into the sky. It's because there's vultures flying around, I think. I think they might have a kill somewhere here. Isn't she beautiful? This lioness is called Amber Eyes, and she's part, this whole pride is called the Nkuhuma Pride. Now, we're not seeing any boys with these lions because that's actually, you might have watched The Lion King, maybe you think that that's how lion prides work, but a lion pride is actually just females and cubs. That is what a lion pride consists of. And then the males will actually move about in a territory that will include the territories of several different females. Sorry, bear with me one second. Hi, thanks so much. Cheers, guys. Cool, thanks so much. Sorry, everybody, just chatting to somebody else. They're beautiful, aren't they? And these lionesses are absolutely incredible. They've got eight growing cubs to feed, as well as themselves. And of course, they don't get fed here. They have to hunt and catch their own food, which they do incredibly successfully. They manage to hunt and catch things like antelope, zebra, buffalo, all kinds of things. Right now, though, they're just taking the opportunity to have a little bit of an afternoon nap. This pride is called the Nkuhuma Pride. That's a difficult name to say, isn't it? It's a very difficult name to say, so we have to all try it together. Nkuhuma. And it's named, it means, it's from the local language here, that means the brown ivory tree, because they were found in the shade of a brown ivory tree once before. So this is the Nkuhuma Pride. And look at their gorgeous little cubs. Can you believe that you're getting to watch lion cubs right here and right now? Playing. Gorgeous. Hello, little face peeking out from behind the branches. Well, unfortunately, although maybe fortunately, because I'm really glad that we did get to have a look at the lions, but unfortunately it's time to say goodbye to Windsor Woods. So from myself and the entire Safari Live team, and Dave, of course, is going to give you a big thumbs up for all of your wonderful questions that you sent through, it's time for us to say goodbye. Have a fantastic school day further, and I hope that you're on the back of our safari vehicle soon. Bye-bye. And back for the rest of our audience, thank you very much. I really do appreciate it. I know how much it means, well, I'm sure you all understand how much it means to have kids watching this at school and be able to share in these incredible moments. Now, I'm going to do some repositioning, have a chance to catch up with one of my, maybe my favourite Pride of Lions. In the meantime, let's head across to Brent, who's found something stripey.
Well, we can just make out a stripe or three through the now thickening greenery that is the Cumbrian woodland here on the crest. So, lovely herd of zebras. Not the best view we've had of them, but there are lots of zebras around at the moment taking advantage of that green thush. Okay, let's keep going. So, wild dogs apparently did a big loopity-loop from the tracks and they've gone back to the west. So I'm heading down to sort of the last area of tracks, see if we've got any luck. Taxons checking for that female leopard around the gate. So I'm just trying to see if we can get an update from Arethusa. So one of the great things about coming back from leave is you get to reacquaint yourself with everything. So it's amazing to see how much it's greened up since I've been gone. And it is so much fun to just drive around and soak in the wonderful African atmosphere. Now, quite lucky that when I'm on holiday and I get to stay in the bush quite often as well, so not too bad. And a big thank you for all the welcome backs and the congratulations. We do really do appreciate it, and exciting year ahead. Now, that's not something we're going to hear quite a long time. Woodlands yet, Brian?
No woodlands.
No woodlands. What date did I say? 16th. 16th or 18th of November, I said. Hello, wildly beast, and there's just a... Oh, apparently I said the 31st of October, so I was definitely wrong. Wait, oh, wildebeest hiding. But the one nice thing with this green flush is we're getting an incredible amount of general game. So zebra, wildebeest, giraffe, breeding herds. What did you spot, mister? Spot as a leopard, I'd be much appreciative. What have you spotted? Are you just being cautious? So this is a wildebeest bull. There's you. Funny looking critters, aren't they? If you have any ponderings, musings, or questions on the blue wildebeest or the blue gnu, you can send them through to us using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter or email questions@wildearth.tv. He looks in relatively good nick. Quite an old boy, you can see. Doesn't quite have the same boss of a buffalo, but you can see how weathered the horns are there. And you can see how he does scrape them against trees as well. You can see the little bits of coloration there. Now, even though they look like they're a cow or related to buffalo, they're not. They're an antelope. They're actually more closely related to hartebeest. Unfortunately, we don't have any hartebeest here. Here we go, mister. Well, let's go have a look a little bit further, see what he might have spotted. Oh, I'm causing traffic jams, excuse me. Let's just go off. I'm going quite slowly. Hello, the sweet Perry. Where do animals go during the rain? Well, they don't have houses to go into, so they stay out in the bush. I'm just going to have a quick afternoon meeting. Yeah, there we go. Who's coming down the road? Oh, it's Taxon. I know, I've seen Taxi already today, or on the radio at least. I was hoping it was someone from this side. Hello, everyone. Loot, I saw the Morven console there where it looks like the cross, but did you check Sydney's?
Yeah, nothing.
Okay. I'll try to get an update from these guys exactly where she crossed. So we're just talking about the leopards and where they're maneuvering to and what they're up to. And hopefully, between one of us, we're going to find a leopard. Fingers crossed, it's going to be the killer bees. And also, I do enjoy a good bout of birding, so I am keeping my eyes out specifically for cuckoos. Now, I am convinced, and there's no actual good reason why I'm convinced, that this year there's going to be a lesser or Madagascar cuckoo somewhere in this area. Those are really rare cuckoos. The last one I think was seen in the Sabi Sands about 10 years ago. So fingers crossed this is the year. James says we haven't seen a classes cuckoo yet. Well, I did hear one calling earlier, so I will keep my eye out. They are very small, very exquisitely beautiful, bright green and white little birds. Okay. So while I try to find out what's happening in Arethusa, see if there's any shenanigans happening, we're going to go back to Jamie and the incredible Inca Humas.
That scorpion sting, the worst part was how itchy it was. Are we?
Yes.
Hello. I'm sorry about that. I don't know where my comms have gone at all. They have completely vanished. I did get stung by a scorpion, as you may or may not have gathered. When did we go live, Dave?
Yeah, about 30 seconds ago.
Oh, right. Okay. We did hear that. Cool. So, yes, indeed, I got stung by a scorpion. You're a Plectes, if you really want to know, which is a thick-tailed scorpion. I just want to double-check and see if I've got comms again. Oh, the joys. It's good to be back. Oh, there we go. There we go. It's all working again. So thank you so much to all of you sending through your welcome backs and your congratulations. I really appreciate it. We're very, very grateful, very appreciative. And of course, it is lovely to be back in the bush once again. Not that we were far, but to have a chance to see these incredible lions and to see how much the cubs have grown in the 2 weeks that I have been away is a true privilege. I always miss them, you know, whenever we go away, just to be able to spend that time with them in the way that we have been. And I think this, I don't think I have ever spent as much time as we have spent with a lion pride as we have with the Inca Humas. It's just been a truly incredible privilege. Look at them little bellies up in the air. You guys have got so big. And they're looking good as well, they really are. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I think number 8 is hiding off in the back there. So all 8 of the cubs are there. And there we go. So Monique in London, sorry, I am struggling to hear your question, so I'm not ignoring you. But Monique, I did get your question coming through. And Monique, you wanted to know if the mange looks better to me, and it really does. Obviously, I was very concerned while I was away. I was scared of what I was coming back to in terms of the changes in the Inca Huma cubs. But they really look absolutely fine. I think that they're going to, their genetics, the fact that they've been so successful with their hunting, I think this lion pride's going to be okay. They're a little bit itchy, and some of them have a few bald patches, but they actually look better to me. Do they look better? I mean, I've been away for 2 weeks, but to me, they actually look better than they did when I left. And one at the back is a little bit more... Yes, you've got a little bit of mange, don't you? That's the one with the floppy ear, the floppy left ear. Hello, gorgeous. And that will probably stay for the rest of its life. Well, there's a chance that that could stay for the rest of its life. But it really does look better to me, which is, of course, an enormous comfort. And the adults don't seem to be showing any sign of it. I don't know if anybody had noticed any signs of mange while I've been away on the adults. But to me, the adults look absolutely fine. Somebody's missing, though. I've only got 4 females here. So I'm not sure who it is. Probably the youngest lioness, if I had to guess, but of course I've been so out of the loop. And it's a very strange feeling when you come back from 2 weeks of being away. You don't... Everything feels slightly off-kilter. I feel terribly rusty, so do excuse me. I've forgotten how to speak words in a coherent manner, but I am going to do my utmost to continue to improve upon that. But you do feel rusty and you forget, well, you don't know where all the animals are, and it's just a matter of reacquainting yourselves with the bush. But it's good to see that the Nkuhumas have been doing incredibly well. Everybody looks thoroughly full-bellied. Yes, slightly itchy. The cubs at the back in particular do look slightly itchy, so the mange is still there. For those of you who are new to these live safaris, perhaps you are joining us for the first time. This is a live safari, and this is here in the middle of a vast conservation area known as the Greater Kruger National Park area. So it's an absolutely massive wilderness zone, bigger than certain small countries, 8.5 million acres, 4 million hectares in terms of size. So it's absolutely massive, and there are lots and lots of animals around this particular area, and lots of lions in this particular part of South Africa. South Africa is very fortunate in that we have a very solid surviving population of wild lions. And what a privilege it is to get to spend time in their lives. And of course, look at you. She's holding the other lioness. That's so sweet. Paws on either side of her. From what I hear, the Nkuhumas have been thoroughly unstoppable while we've been away, catching buffalo after buffalo. I did see a buffalo herd on my way through, and they were looking particularly nervous, probably because they know that they're in an area where the Nkuhumas are. All looking full-bellied. No sign of pregnancy on Amber Eyes, Dave? No, I didn't think so either. When we pulled up and we saw her earlier, so I guess either she didn't, that pregnancy wasn't successful, or we were mistaken. Perhaps she just had a very large meal of buffalo that particular day. Her four lionesses and their eight gorgeous cubs. Look at you, panting in the heat of the day. The mange does look better. All right, I'm just really having a closer look. The younger ones, which was to be expected, the younger ones seem to be the worse afflicted. But even they are not nearly as bad as the sticks were. Dave, I have a feeling comms are coming through, but I'm not getting any of them. Sorry, I'm not ignoring your questions. As you know, live... No, what was that? She's testing. I get the ing part. I got the ing part of the testing, vaguely. Champ. Okay. Fiddle with the volume. Sorry, everybody. At least we've got lions to keep us thoroughly entertained. Okay. Haha. There I heard, Kirsty. Hello, Kirsty. It's lovely to hear your voice once again in full, even if you do sound somewhat distorted. Oh, there we go. Kirsty, by the way, is our lovely director, who I have missed along with the rest of the team. So it's lovely to have her voice in our ears once more. And she is the one responsible for feeding through your questions, hence why it is slightly problematic if I cannot hear her. But I seem to be okay. I think that was okay that time. We'll figure it out as we go along. Hot little cubs. Which one's this? Now it's getting really difficult to actually tell the difference between different age groups. Before it was relatively simple. Aww. Going up to say hello to mom. Or aunt, maybe. Butting heads gently. No rest for wary moms where cubs are involved. Doing that standard lion greeting of the head rub. And are trying to find a comfortable spot. Well, they're still lactating, the lionesses. Are they? That's incredible. I'm very, very impressed with them. Maybe that's one of the mothers of the younger set of cubs. It's hard to tell if I can't see her face properly. But that's amazing to see them still suckling. I was relatively certain when I got back there would be very little of that going on.
Jamie's not hearing because
what's Kirst asking?
No.
You getting them. This is devastating. Most devastating. Let me just check and see if it's not my ear. No, it's not my earpiece. Earpiece is working perfectly. Oh, look. Suckling going on. I'm just going to be quiet for a second so we can maybe listen to the sounds of them grumbling at each other and then I can figure out what's going on.
We can link to Brent while we do this.
Okay. While we do a little bit of a fiddle with our radio comms to see what on earth is going on, let us jump back on board with Brent because luckily he's out there and hopefully he can hear Kirsty.
Every herd of impala we go past at the moment, I'm just staring intently, trying to see if there's a little baby. Wouldn't it be great to catch an impala birth live on a safari live? Little ones from last year, looking for their next brothers and sisters. We know what glorious fun little impala can be as well when they decide to start playing. And Brian and I are almost hunting impala at the moment, looking for that first baby of the year. Well, hello to James Dungan. Now, of course, I've just got back from leave today, and James is wondering if I had any good safari sightings while I was on leave. Well, yes, indeedy. I had some very good wild dog sightings. We had wild dogs kill an impala and feed off the impala right next to us. And what else did we see that was very nice? Some good bush pig and some incredible rhino sightings at an undisclosed position, but I think one day I must have seen 29 different rhinos, which was very nice. Oh. So it sounds like not much happening on Arethusa. It seems those wild dogs have headed south towards Londolozi, so we're gonna leave the area and maybe go to a gander down the southern boundary. Who knows, maybe Queen Karula is going to grace the killer bees with her presence. Remember, hashtag Safari Live on Twitter if you want to ask us any questions or have any comments. It's just so wonderful. Magnificent skies around at the moment. Massive cumulus clouds building all over the place. Look at that, isn't that absolutely gorgeous? A fluffy marshmallow-like looking clouds there. Those are cumulus clouds. Now, who can tell me the difference between a cumulus cloud and a cumulus nimbus cloud? If you know the answer, pop me an email, questions@wildearth.tv, or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. What is the difference between a cumulus cloud and a cumulus nimbus cloud? Oh, Brian. Hello, little one. There we go, a scrub hair. Look at those developed veins on his ears. And you can see how thick they are, and that's because of the heat. And you can see how skinny the ear is. Hold on. Bye-bye, scrub hair. Wild dogs, wild dogs, wild dogs. I was on the wrong radio channel. Tex, I've got the update. I'm on Gowri Main Junction, Philemons. Okay, so dogs, 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 dogs! My favorite animal! Hoppa! Hold on, Brian. Handbrake turn, Brian? Maybe not, maybe not. Maybe not. No, no, maybe not just yet. And for once, we happen to be in the right spot for easy, fast driving down main roads. Now, for those of you who might not have been following wild dogs, you have to get there quickly. It's so incredibly easy to lose them. The painted wolf. find another life as a race car driver. I think I'd quite enjoy that, actually. Okay, so they're somewhere around here. Fortunately, we were quite close. Quite often we get the call about wild dogs and you're... There we go. For once, are they not running? Ah, oh, they're snoozing. Well, we now know what our plan is. We ain't gonna be moving for the next while. So I'm trying to see which pack it is. Looks like three dogs, but there's been two different packs of three dogs recently. There's been a breakaway pack from the Orpin or Ngala pack. And there's also been, of course, the three survivors of the Lower Sabi. But now you never know who's going to arrive, because all the puppies from the Investec pack and also from the Sands pack and the Toulon pack are now adults. So they are running with the rest of the pack. I can only see three, Brian. One, two, and then the other one was walking off. Where's he gone? Oh, there he is. Three. So, oh, he's laying down now. Let me just move a little bit. Now, say, there's one little branch in the way, but there we go. Okay, so this is the new pack. That individual dog has got these very distinct white spots on its side. We can just see the one on his back left leg there. So this is a breakaway from the Ngala pack. So these are dispersals. Wouldn't it be fantastic if they met up with the survivors of the Lower Sabi pack? Now, Daniel is wondering why wild dogs are in such low numbers. There's only 3,500 left in the whole of Africa. Now, there's been lots of different reasons. Mostly the biggest threat to wild dogs historically, which is the reason for their numbers to decline so rapidly, was a loss of habitat. They need a massive area. Your average pack of wild dog needs about 120,000 acres to roam. And so there aren't too many areas in Africa left that are that big and has that much space for the wild dogs to roam. The largest and healthiest population of wild dogs in South Africa is the Greater Kruger. And there's only about 200, just over 200 dogs. Now, for it to be a long-term viable breeding population, you need to be around 450. Now, of course, there are other things that also threaten wild dogs, and two of the biggest threats to wild dogs at the moment is rabies and canine distemper. Now, being such social animals, all those type of diseases spread through the pack like wildfire. Now, this particular pack has been treated, so they are inoculated. So I did spend a bit of time with Grant, who's a friend of mine. He's in charge of the Endangered Wildlife Trust wild dog section for the Lowveld. So fortunately, I'm quite up to date on all that, which packs have had their injections and which ones haven't. Now, doesn't look like they're too well fed. It is still a bit hot for them to get moving. But with this cloud cover coming in, that could change quite quickly. Now, remember, wild dogs are crepuscular hunters. So crepuscular means they're most active at dusk and dawn. Oh, look at those wonderful big ears. Look at that. Isn't this just... Now, Melinda is wondering, how do wild dogs find meat? Well, Melinda, they are what you call coursing predators. So the opposite to sort of lion and leopard. Oh, mate, not meat. Okay, well, that makes a bit more sense. So Melinda, what happens? You have dispersals from big packs like this. So generally, when a wild dog pack gets to over 20, two or three, or sometimes four individuals of that pack will disperse. And they'll keep moving and keep calling till they find another two or three unrelated dogs, and that's how they form the new pack. And quite often they can cover incredibly massive distances from their natal pack. Some dogs have been recorded doing over 300 kilometers in search of new packs. Oh, while the dogs are sleeping, Brian, we never get a chance to get these guys. On the ground next to us here is a massive Pompilidae spider hunting wasp. He is a beastie. You do not want to be stung by that thing. Now, it's a big female by the looks of things, and I was hoping she might be digging a hole. I'm trying to see. Can you see if she's carrying anything, Brian? Doesn't look like it. Now, when you see a spider hunting wasp on the ground like this, she's quite often looking for her hole. So, and she's probably stung and caught a whole bunch of spiders or caterpillars as well. And then she lays a single egg in each of them and then digs a little hole and buries them. And it's always amazing because sometimes it always looks like they've forgotten where they dug their hole, and it can take them a bit of time to find the hole again. And he's coming too close, eh? Oh, magic colors. I mean, that metallic sheen on those wings is spectacular. Now, no, this one isn't that. So some of them have a bit of, I have orange antennae, this one doesn't. This, if I remember correctly, is the largest of the spider hunting wasps. And it's now too close, we can't see where she's going. But I will keep an eye on her if I see her pop out again and start digging. Okay. Let's just maybe move a little bit. Now, Emma's wondering, are wild dogs in danger of being poached? Not specifically targeted, Emma, but what can happen is they pick up snares that are set for other creatures. That is quite common. You often actually find wild dogs with snares, especially once they move out of the protected areas and into community areas, into farming areas while they're searching, especially these dispersal packs. But fortunately, if we ever see a wild dog with a snare, we're very quick to call the vets and get it removed. See if we can have a look. I think this dog is going to be one of my favorites if they hang around. It's got those very distinct white spots on the other side, but now it's moving back to the rest of the pack. Oh, stood on a fawn. Whoopsie. Get that thorn out. Just trying to find you a gap through the bush here. I suppose that'll do for now till he settles down. Oh, thorn has been retrieved. Now, I just want to have a check. Yes, it's a male dog with these very distinct white markings. And now, just before I went on leave on last time, here we go. This is the same pack that chased and nearly caught young Hosanna, Karula's male cub. He's doing a bit of greeting. Now, hopefully, fingers crossed, that we're gonna be here for the greeting ceremony that they do before they get up to go hunting. So, when, Brian? There we go. Now, even though they do look like dogs, they, as I said, they split from domestic dogs over a million years ago, and they've got different dentition. So they've got their teeth have a very sort of almost, it's invisible really when you look at it now, but a slightly serrated edge. Now, looking at the way they're lying, it's not so apparent now with the dispersal animals, but if they happen to join up with another dispersal pack, it's a very, very fascinating thing. The success of the pack is almost, it's visibly determined whether that pack is going to be successful, judging on how close the animals lie together. So a new dispersal pack where the animals lie very close together is generally going to form and become a successful long-term surviving pack. If you get a dispersal pack where they lie quite far from each other, it is often the fact then that that pack will actually probably break out and those animals will continue dispersing. Now, in this case, when you've got three related dogs from the same pack, it's not such a big deal if they lie a little bit further away from each other. But if they were with three other unrelated dogs, how close the unrelated dogs, only really in the first 6 months of the pack being formed, how close they lie to each other is a very good indicator on whether that pack is going to be successful in the long term or not. So looking at them, as I said, they don't look like they ate too much this morning. So hopefully, fingers crossed, we're going to be on a crepuscular hunt with the African wild dog in not too long. Remember, this is live. We're with the most endangered canid in southern Africa, live from the Sabi Sands Game Reserve in the beautiful country of South Africa. Now, Matthew is wondering if I've got any tips for tracking or following wild dogs. Well, today the tip is follow taxon. But normally, dogs can be very difficult to track because they can move so quickly. So the best thing to do is actually try and follow them in multiple vehicles. And you just try to bounce around each other. Even when you're following them, when you've actually found them, keeping up with them is a problem. So a lot of guesswork, trying to think like the animal, get into that position where they're most likely to go. But again, with dogs, it's like a bombshell in any matter. If a diker jumps up and they're gone after that. But for following wild dogs, be prepared to bend the odd steering arm. Probably the best way to follow wild dogs would be in a helicopter. This is definitely not one of the more commonly seen animals. And there seems to be a bit of a shift in wild dog population dynamics in our part of the Sabi Sands. If we think about last year, we saw the Investec pack and the Sabi Sands pack regularly. The Sands pack, or Toulon pack, is now way down south in the reserve, and we haven't seen them in ages. The Investec pack, Dend and Kruger, seems to be spending a lot more time in the Manyeleti, but they have come close to our northern boundary, but they haven't popped in for a visit that I am aware of. But we do have these two new packs, or two new dispersal packs. They haven't seemed to have met up yet. This breakaway is from the Ingala pack, which comes from the Timbavati, and of course the lower Sabi survivors. Now, the lower Sabi survivors is quite a sad but spectacular story. So canine distemper got into the pack, wiped out the vast majority of them. I think there were 21 dogs and only three survived. But the positive of that is if those dogs have survived that, they are going to carry quite a lot of immunity to distemper. So in terms of their genetics going forward, especially if they're going to mate with a pack that's already been inoculated, could be very, very good for the future sort of wild dog populations. Now, it's amazing how this is completely changed in the last 10 years. You no longer need to dart to inoculate an animal. You can actually, if you get a carcass, you can lace it that full of pills, and you can inoculate against rabies and distemper. So it's become a lot cheaper and a lot easier. Now, it doesn't work for all animals, but for the dogs in particular, the new drugs seem to be very effective. Now, we can see the sun is starting to go down a little bit. We can see the colors starting to form in the sky there. Lots of cloud cover around, but I don't know. I don't think any rain, Brian. What do you think? Dubious. Maybe this evening. It is always special to spend time with wild dogs, or any African animal for that matter. Even when they are steeping, look at that. Now we're looking through to the foothills of the Drakensberg Mountains there. And you can see, generally an area that would always traditionally get quite a lot more rain than we would here in the Sabi Sands, as you head up towards the Highveld grasslands. It is quite a pretty picture, almost like a watercolor. Well, well done to Janet, who's got the cloud quiz correct. I asked, what is the difference between a cumulus cloud and a cumulus nimbus cloud? Nimbus means rain, so it's a cumulus cloud that's raining. So well done, Janet. Now, these summer skies and summer clouds do provide some spectacular evenings and vistas. But for me, there's nothing more spectacular than the smelly, sleepy African wild dog.
Not too smelly.
Not too smelly, but I think we're upwind of them. But while we sit here with the African wild dogs, of course, we're not the only car out there, and Jamie is still with the incredible Inkahumas.
How incredible is it that the wild dog has decided to come out and greet Brent on his first day back? And in the meantime, we've got a moment to spend with these incredible lions, looking thoroughly peaceful, and I'm probably going to have to make space at some point for some of the other vehicles to come and join and enjoy this particular moment. But for now, we have the time to just spend a little bit of time with them and enjoy their company. Look at this little faces. I cannot get over how much they've grown. You can still see the youngest set, though. This, I think, is one of the youngest ones. I think. Well, maybe it's not that easy. I need to see them all standing up next to each other to really keep track. Oh, big yawn. That is the oldest female of the Inkahumas, so the mother of the middle set of cubs. So for our new viewers, there's actually three different age groups here. The oldest, the middle, and the youngest. And they're obviously by three different mothers. The lioness that's yawning at the moment, she's the mother of the middle set of cubs. She also happens to be the oldest of the lionesses. And you can actually tell, we have a look at her, if she yawns for us again, which would be very convenient, she's got a chipped canine tooth. And generally that's the best way of aging a lion, is to actually have a look at the condition of their teeth, the wear and the tear, because obviously their wild lifestyle takes its toll. And particularly on essentially their tools of their trade, which are their massive canines. She's also got a very, very dark nose, and there is a tendency, not always, you've got to be careful with this, because of course it is genetic and it changes depending from lion to lion. There is a tendency for lions as they age for their noses to darken in color, and hers is almost completely black. You can see she's cleaning herself using those incredible spurs along the tongue to scrape through the fur, and if you look carefully you can actually see the grooves being left behind as she drags that tongue across that thick coat, picking up all kinds of ticks and parasites and dirt. Lions generally are not the most fastidious of creatures, but they do clean themselves and they clean each other's cubs, but with saliva like theirs, you can imagine it sort of does spread a great deal of bacteria onto their coat as well. Hello, gorgeous girl. Now, Liz, you want to know if the other females of the group have cubs, will they hold off on introducing them in order to basically make sure that their cubs are strong enough to deal with the rest of the pride? And yes, absolutely, that will be. Sorry, let me just turn this down. There's a lot of noise happening in my ear. Yes, absolutely they will. So generally, unless I know, but for all of our new viewers, when a lioness has cubs, she actually hides them away for the first 6 weeks of their lives. And she does this for a very good reason. The life of a lion is not a gentle one. And particularly where older cubs are concerned, it does occasionally happen. If the lioness introduces her cubs too early to the rest of the pride, they could actually be killed by the sort of boisterous nature of some of the older cubs. Now, my suspicion is that if the lionesses, like the youngest lioness or Amber Eyes, do have cubs, my suspicion would be is that they might, it could be difficult to tell because these cubs are now old enough to know better. They're a little bit more in control of their actions. But that being said, I think there's a good chance that she might actually, the mother concerned, might actually keep those cubs hidden a little bit longer. Maybe just that extra week. That will make all of the difference in the life of a lion cub. We've seen how fast they grow and how they develop in strength and coordination. And they just need to be able to deal with the actions of the other cubs as they try to play with them. And we've seen these mothers from the older lioness protecting the cubs, as we've been fortunate enough with this particular litter of cubs, or this particular generation of cubs, to really follow the entire cycle of their lives and their introduction to the pride. And I know that Brent had that incredible sighting where the youngest set were introduced to the rest of the pride. And you could see how incredibly protective the mother was of them. And you'd find that that would definitely be the case if a new set of cubs were to be introduced to this particular group. But lions are tough. They're incredibly tough. I've just noticed that Amber Eyes actually has quite a nasty limp. She's favoring her... What's the side? Left. I forgot my left from my right there for a second. Her left front leg has been injured in some way, but I don't think it's anything serious, and it's amazing how quickly these animals truly recover and heal from their injuries. She looks absolutely fine to me. It was probably an injury while they were hunting. It might even just be a slightly strained tendon. Hey, girl. You'll see in a bit when she does get up and move. If she does get up and move, you'll see when she walks. It's just a little bit of a limp. I mean, remember when the cub, all those months ago, had that terrible limp and that injured hip? We were all so concerned about it, and it was absolutely fine. So Amber Eyes will be fine, but it's just amazing the resilience of these creatures, even from a very young age. But yes, if I were a lioness, I think I'd keep my cubs hidden away for a little bit longer. Ah, now, Vulpine Wolf Girl, you want to know what breed of dog is equivalent to the size of a lioness. There isn't really one, to be honest. I mean, a bull mastiff might come close in terms of weight. These lionesses probably weigh, Amber Eyes and some of the bigger lionesses, like this older lioness, she probably weighs close to about 130, maybe even 150 kilograms. Not right now, because they look actually relatively empty-bellied, but probably at their fullest, close to 150 kilograms. That's over 300 pounds. That's a massive, massive animal. A Great Dane would probably be a good estimate in terms of height. They're roughly about the height of a Great Dane, maybe even slightly shorter. But just in terms of sheer bulk, there isn't really an animal, a dog breed, that fully matches up to the dimensions of a fully grown lioness. But if we wanted to look at the cubs, now that's a different story. And that might have been what you meant, Vulpine Wolf Girl, in terms of cub size. So what dog breed would match up, roughly equate to the size of the cubs at the moment? The oldest ones are roughly the size of a... This is a difficult question. They're probably very solid. Maybe about a small... I'm saying Vimarana, because I have a Vimarana, so I know how big she is and how much she weighs. So the oldest cubs are probably close to a small female Vimarana. Maybe just a little bit shorter. Just a little bit smaller than a German short-haired pointer or the equivalent. And the younger set of cubs are probably Fox Terrier-ish size. I'm going to have to brush up on my dog breeds. Actually, we should have been doing this all along, equating the lion cubs to dog breeds as they grew. From Chihuahua size to the size that they're at now. No, Vimarana is a slight exaggeration. They're not quite that big. Now that I see them standing up, I see one of them standing up. Not quite as big as a Vimarana, although it probably weighs about the same. The cubs probably weigh, they're solid, stocky little creatures. That cub probably weighs close to 30 kilograms. Unbelievably strong. Going to see if it can try its luck with some milk from the milk bar. Very impressed with the lionesses that they're still lactating. It has been a time of plenty. What is happening in there? There's lots of movement going on in that weeping wattle tree. Oh, did you get stuck by any chance? Little bit. Maybe just a little bit. Okay. Out and unscathed. Going to investigate. Now, those are two of the oldest cubs. And they must be... Sure, how old are they now? 6 months, close to. Just under 6 months old now. Time flies. working thoroughly, in very good condition. Still scratching a little bit. Patchy bits around their elbows from the mange. Oh, little one. Another scratch. At least they've got the claws for it, I suppose. Now, I'm looking at them. I've just been watching the conditions that the lions are in. They don't seem to be all that full, and yet there must have been a kill here somewhere. Dave, were they on a kill this morning?
They were
on a kill. Was it a small kill?
Was relatively young buffalo.
Relatively young buffalo. Okay, so they were on a kill this morning. Relatively young buffalo. Obviously, there are this many mouths to feed. It's not quite the same as when it was just the Nkuhumas feeding for themselves. Now, I don't know where the rest of that buffalo is, but it has certainly attracted the attention of many, many scavengers. Was it with you, Dave, that the white-headed vulture was seen? I heard a report of a white-headed vulture. That was very cool. Was that here, or was it? It was here. Ooh, that changes things. Yeah, I wonder if it's still around. That would be very exciting. What are you doing, little one? Oh, those poor lionesses. It's so exhausting being a mum and having these constantly active little creatures, or almost constantly active. Cat in Tampa, while we watch this little lion cub suckle, he wants to know if the older cubs drink the milk, will the lionesses run out when it comes time for the younger cubs? And it's a difficult one. Yes, for the most part, the older cubs tend to have the advantage because they can actually fight off their younger siblings. Although we've generally seen it seems to resolve itself in after a bit of growling and fussing, quite an equanimical way. And that everybody gets a chance to suckle. But yes, the older lion cubs, in the same way they do at kills, can monopolize a lot of the food. And obviously, the females are not bottomless pits in terms of milk production. They can't just keep producing milk on tap. So if the older cubs do manage to drink most of it, then yes, the younger cubs won't have any. But then again, of course, by the time if any new cubs are born to Amber Eyes or the youngest lioness, by the time they are born, the chances are all of the other mothers will have stopped lactating. So it will be up to Amber Eyes, and if the youngest lioness falls pregnant, up to the youngest lioness to keep things going. I would think that with the bellies that they have at the moment, even though they have eaten this morning, I think there's still a very, very good chance that they could be up and about and hunting this evening, especially because it really looks as though it's going to storm, and I'm so excited. This particular November, October-November weather has been far better than last year. It has felt much more normal. So hopefully it does rain, which is, of course, perfect hunting weather for these lions. And apparently the weatherman is predicting that it is going to rain. I have my own weatherman. What do you think, Dave? Downpour Dave? Downpour Dave doesn't think it's going to rain. Ooh, spanner in the works, Dave. Going against the experts. Certainly has that hot, heavy stillness. I bet you the lions know. I bet you they are far more accurate. I mean, I have no proof for that statement. It's supposition. But my suspicion would be is that most of the animals out here are aware of when it's actually going to rain. Certainly things like tortoises are out and about just before it starts to rain. This cub chewing on the dead pulsiforum. It's the type of tree that he's chewing on. They've lost that baby look to me. They don't have those sort of cub faces anymore. They look like little miniature lions now, particularly the older ones. And these two at the back. And I think think it will be well worth spending the sort of last portions of our evening with this particular pride of lions. We will have to leave them in a couple of minutes. I think we'll go and see what else we can see. And of course, it's always nice after an extended absence from an area to go and explore and reacquaint oneself with that particular, or with what's happening around me. So I do want to go on a little bit of a bumble and then come back to these lions when I can. But we'll have a chance to see that, or we'll have a chance to do that a little bit later. I'm still really keen on seeing that white-headed vulture, though. I might go and have a look for it as well. I've been scanning the treetops while I've been sitting here. Cheers, guys. I haven't seen it. It would be a first for me. I don't think I've seen a white-headed vulture in the Sabi Sands. I've seen them in Kruger, but I haven't seen them in the Sabi Sands. And there we go, all the cubs coming together. All in all, a thoroughly peaceful scene. Could not be more unconcerned. Well, we wait for our lion pride to get up and moving. It sounds as though Brent's wild dogs are thinking about doing just that. Let's head over and have a look at what they get up to.
Okay, so they are showing a bit of sign of getting moving. It's the right time of the day. As I said, they're crepuscular hunters, most active at dusk and dawn. So they should be getting moving shortly. Here we go. Look at that, doing a bit of defleeing. Oh, look at that. I think he's becoming my favorite dog. What do you think, Brian? I really like those white spots on him. Now, here we go, look at that, very prominent spots. Snows. Spot the impala. Oh, he's going the right direction. He's going towards the impala. This is going to be very exciting if he sees those impala. Now see, look at this, almost the one side. Look how dark he is on the left. Dark, dark dog. He's almost a little Africa on his back leg. Maybe not quite an Africa, but Africa with a bit of imagination. Here we go. Next one coming through. This is the female who's coming to join him. Oh, they're going to go to the water. I'm going to get there. Might, I don't know if the elephants have splashed all that water away. Wild dogs are really fond of water. Oh, there you go. And mud, they like to cool down in it. There we go, look at that, isn't that wonderful? Wow, isn't this great? So a quick cool down before the hunt starts. Hi, Samantha. Samantha is wondering, how big are wild dogs in comparison to a domestic dog? Weight-wise, probably not too much difference from a large Alsatian, but height-wise, they're a bit taller at the shoulder. And how many pups can they have? I think the record for wild dog pups that I know, that I've seen, is 22 in a single litter. They're heading straight towards where those impala were. They haven't spotted them. The impala have just sort of snuck a little bit further to the north. There's still one more male dog coming. Here he comes. Joggity jog, jog, jog. Doesn't want to get left behind. He was the one who was sleeping under the bush. Now, they're capable of incredible stamina. Okay, now this is where following wild dogs becomes very tricky, and you've got to actually almost pre-guess what's going to happen, otherwise you can often lose them. So let's go. We don't want to get too far behind. We know there's impala right there. Now we're gonna see if the dogs see them. Their ears will go flat. They won't stalk like a lion, but they will try to break their outline a little bit. They haven't spotted them yet, or have they? Look at that. Is his ears going flat yet? Yes, the ears are going flat. The impala haven't seen them. Now there's zebra up ahead as well. Now zebras can be very aggressive animals. So look at that. See how flat that front dog's ears are. Look at her ears. She's keeping them right up against her skull. So that big satellite sort of radar dish isn't spotted by the potential prey up ahead. Wendy would like to know whether I've ever followed wild dogs hunting in a helicopter. Not yet. I'm hoping to one day. Look at that, look at that. This is so awesome. Doggies, 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 doggies. The impala are just beyond them. The impala still haven't seen them. There's a zebra in the road, but they're not after the zebra. Now guys, I will try my best to stick with them, but there is a possibility once they go into the bush here at high speed, because look at that, look at that, look at that. You can see the impala, you can see the dogs. Oh, the dwarf mongoose gave it away. Hold on, hold on. That, did you hear that? Chitchir! That was the dwarf mongoose going, wild dog, and the impala didn't even stop. Fortunately, they're running parallel to the road. That wasn't a very serious attempt, those darn dwarf mongoose. Now, the amazing thing is, now we've followed lion and leopard and everything, and as soon as an impala sees them, they snort. With a wild dog, they don't. They just run. Elizabeth says, what a wonderful first day back for you, Brent. Indeedy, Elizabeth. Great to be back with Safari Live, and great to be back in the bush, and great to be with the African wild dogs, and of course, the killer bees. So far, and it is not always the case, but the female seems to be leading the hunts at the moment. It also just depends on who's the most hungry. But the best news is, the pack is moving deeper into Juma. Now, this could be really fun coming up. We've got some zebra. Zebra will often chase wild dogs. Big adult zebra. There's a zebra in the road. Not really a threat to the dogs. They might try avoid the zebra. Oh, these zebras are, these are chicken zebras. Off they run, that's unusual. I wonder where the stallion is. Zebra stallions normally chase wild dogs. Here they are, dogs about to jog into view. They're going deeper and deeper into Juma. Isn't that the best news? So I just need an update on the radio. Stations, Mahloa are still mobile, northeast down Philemon's Cut line. Oh, the zebras are going to chase them. There we go. Yeah, I filmed that chase. Just come on to Philemon's. They're heading towards Shibam Junction. Okay, so just letting Ephraim know where we are. Those zebras might try to chase the dogs again. You know why they didn't chase immediately. It's a group of young zebras, young stallions, young bucks. Hello, puppies. And isn't this nice? They're going right down the road for a change. Now, if they're heading towards quarantine, I've just heard a report there could be a male lion around there. All happening here. Should I check what Jamie's position is? Okay, man, just go around. The termite mound, Ephraim's come to join us, and it's always better to have two of you following dogs. Oh, what do you mean? Oh, time for a scent mark by the looks of things. Now, scent marking will be done by the whole pack. Okay. So Jamie is apparently on central. I think it might be a good idea. I'm just going to let Final Troll tell Jamie to start heading towards quarantine. If the dogs are going that way. They are. Okay, there we go. Hopefully they keep going in this direction. We don't want them to go that way, because that's boundaries not too far away. We want them to head right towards the heart of Juma. Maybe go chase some impala on quarantine where it's nice and open and easier for us to keep up with them. Although they are being quite kind by using Philemon's cut line. It's got a nice big wide road. So I'm constantly checking up ahead to see if we spot potential prey, a duiker, an impala, anything that might set the dogs off. And hopefully they're not disturbed by the irritation of a dwarf mongoose, which I thought we were in for, looked like quite a close run kill there till those mongoose started alarm calling. And then everything just ran as they looked up and saw a wild dog. There was, I think I could actually see the panic in the impala's eyes. Isn't this weird? It's almost like we're part of the pack running parallel with them. Almost want to let out a woo call. Very good question from Romy in Ohio, is wondering, would the dogs take down a buffalo? Three of them, maybe with the drought, a young one that was not in good nick, but in certain areas, big packs will take out young buffalo, not an adult buffalo bull, but there is records of them in Botswana taking out adult buffalo cows. No, don't go that way. Impala, running. Let's see if the dogs have seen it. I've seen it. One dog's seen it. The others are all sleeping. So I'm just going to try to jump ahead of them here, quickly on the corner where I got the opportunity to. Because if they go into this block above Treehouse Waterhole, it is really difficult to stick with them. Let's see where they go. Hopefully they just cut across the top corner of this very thick area and keep heading towards quarantine. They might go down towards Treehouse Dam for a drink and a swim. There they go. So it looks like they're heading possibly down to Treehouse. I'm just going to find a spot where we can hopefully get ahead of them. And let's see where they're going to go. Oh dear. Changing their mind. Now, Tube Jar is wondering, have lions ever chased or attacked African wild dogs? They are the biggest natural threat to wild dogs, and they do kill. Well, we're about to find out whether wild dogs hunt buffalo. I doubt three of them. I saw some buffalo up ahead. Now, with the drought and... they could try, check if there's a sub-adult or a young one. Now, I think it might be one of the first records in the Sabi Sands if we do see them successfully hunt a buffalo. Where are those buffalo now? The buffalo's seen them. Yeah. They're running straight towards the buffalo. I think they're just going to go past the buffalo, unfortunately. Let's try and get you a view of the dogs and the buffalo together. There we go. There we go. Okay. Now, they've chosen a bit of a tricky area. Now they're still heading more or less northeast. Sorry, I'm just trying to keep with them, up with them here. Okay, there they go. You can just see them there. Now this is why, you can see, it's not like a lion and leopard that just sort of walks. They really keep the speed up. Okay, while we keep up with the wild dogs, Jamie's got another surprise.
What a fantastic way to return back to work with the dramatic skies and elephants in the background and, of course, this male lion. So thank you very much for those of you who let us know about this lion that was seen on the Juma Dam camera. Very much appreciated because, of course, now we're here with him. And just, I just want to be quiet for one moment. Maybe you can actually hear the impala alarm calling. Coming through, Dave. It is. You can hear them. It almost sounds like somebody with violent sneeze attack. There you go. You might just be able to hear them. The antelope, everybody in this area is aware of this massive male lion who is clearly unbelievably full. Look at that belly. It is truly impressive to see just how much these Birmingham boys have grown into their own. He actually almost looks as though something's hurting him a little bit on his face, but maybe it's just he's panting. It looks to me, in my brief assessment of him, it looks like Tignor to me. Tignor, or Birmingham boy number 3, the one with a massive scar on his left cheek. Now, of course, we can only see his right cheek. And probably of all of the Birmingham boys, the one with the worst skin condition. Could be a fungus, probably a little bit of mange, most likely. But that looks to me like Tinyo, one of the Birmingham boys that we actually regularly see. And his name means tooth, because you can see his canine on the other side, even when his mouth is closed, through the scar in his lip. He's clearly just been for a drink. Apparently the elephants chased him away. And I noticed on my way through, rushing through into this area, they did so for a good reason. They do have a tiny little calf with them. I'm not sure if you managed to see it on the Juma Dam camera. No. There you go. Perfect. Well done, Dave. Hello, little one. Well done, Dave. And this little one, only a couple of weeks old, still a little bit wobbly on its legs. Oh, stepping over the thorns. Gorgeous. And whilst it would be exceptionally unlikely for a lion out here to go for an elephant calf, it is possible. It is very, very unusual, though. Nevertheless, the elephants don't take any chances, and they will be exceptionally protective of this little one. It's a little male, possibly even the same age as the one that we saw when it was only about an hour old, just a few weeks ago on these live safaris. That truly, hands down, is one of my most magical moments that I've had on Juma since I started working here over a year and a half ago. That little one, of course, was part of Fang's herd. I haven't seen any of the very, very distinctive members, so I think this is a different elephant herd, but I'm not 100% sure. Fang could be there, Fang with her backwards-facing tusk. She could be around there. It's amazing how familiar we become with the different animal characters. I would love for that to be that little elephant calf that I saw when it was just stumbling around a few hours old. In the meantime, though, Tinyo looking thoroughly exhausted, panting away with his massive belly. And that's what I mean. It would be so unlikely for a lion to risk trying to hunt an elephant at this point. It is a time of absolute plenty. I've driven past two buffalo carcasses already, one close to Buffalsook Dam, one that the Nkuhumas hadn't even bothered to feed on. I eventually found it. There is just so much food for the predators at the moment. Definitely not worth taking on an angry elephant herd for a meal. And wherever he's come from, he's clearly eaten something. Now, Jennifer, you looking at his bottom lip, and of course this is usually his uninjured side, you're saying it looks as though he looks a little bit like it's sagging there, perhaps injured in some way. And I think it's just droopy from the heat. The male lions can get quite jowly as they start to get older. Like sort of certain large dogs, their jowls start to droop a little bit. But he was pulling a face earlier, you know that twitch that lions get, or any animal gets, when they're slightly injured and they're uncomfortable, and they're sort of the muscles around their face, if they've got an injury on their face, the muscles around their face sort of constantly contract as a way of expressing their discomfort or trying to ease their discomfort. I don't think he's injured, though. I think he's just a little bit droopy. And some individuals, of course, do lose elasticity in their skin, and you get some that are droopier than others. Right, apparently on this hot, thirsty afternoon, the wild dogs are having a drink.
Well, like everything wild dogs do, they do it quickly. It was a quick slip and a carry on. We managed to keep up with them through that thick block. We lost them once or twice, but now we are still with them, and they're heading straight towards the Twin Dams Road. Mashoa now at Chilipan. Oh, Impala. I've seen them. They're checking. Have they seen them? They haven't seen them. Come, I suppose I am being a little bit unfair. I am sitting probably a good meter and a half higher than them. Oh, and we're gonna get maybe some magic light creeping through. Oh, time for a scent mark. Can see them urinating and also pasting. There you go. Sniff, sniff. Now, one of the really funny things is if you ever see a pack of wild dogs run past a hyena latrine, they always have to. They just can't help themselves. They have to scent mark on top of the hyena scent mark. Oh, what an absolutely spectacular evening. We've got dogs. We've got one of the most spectacular skies I've seen in quite some time. Look at that, isn't that? Oh, you don't get much better than this. What a welcome back to work. Now, which way, left or right? decisions. Two seem to be leaning left, one seems to be leaning right. Now, as I said, I'm hoping that they join up with the Lower Sabi pack survivors. And Monique in London is wondering, would they join up or would they fight? It is impossible to say. It could go either way. But even if they did join up, there might be a bit of sorting out hierarchies. Well, it looks like... Oh, no, I don't think we have a definite decision on direction. North or south, or east. Looks like north it is. Darlene in New Hampshire said she's read that the vocalization of wild dogs is difficult for larger carnivores here, so particularly lions and that. I wouldn't say that. I've definitely seen lions react to the sound of wild dogs on a kill, but they definitely don't make as much noise as certain other animals. So it's a very high-pitched tittering, I suppose, is the best way to describe them on a kill. Oh, we might be going for another drink. I'm about to approach Chele Pan now. So we will do our best to stay with them, but there's some tricky country up ahead. I love that behavior. So when you see wild dogs approach a bigger body of water, that one in particular was doing it, they are very nervous of crocodiles. They almost sort of try to test, see if there's any movement in a little bit bigger bit of water. So nervous. Watching that water's edge. Don't think there are any crocodiles in Chele Pan, but you never know. And if you're a wild dog, it pays to be cautious. I don't know, Brian, can you hear that little rah, 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 rah? That's that little grey tree frog or foam nest frog making noise. Very vocal tree frog. Away from the water. Definitely one of the more nervous species. Oh, look at the reflection. Lovely. And it's my favorite dog of this pack with the white spots, the male. Oh, one of them, the two males and one female. The Ingala Breakaway pack. Thank you. Oh dear. Okay. Oh, sorry, Brian, look at that. That's beautiful. Sorry, I was worrying about where they were going, but look at that exquisite reflection. Magic. Hey, Brian, we've had some good reflections in old Chelepan. Mr. Konuma, now some wild dogs. The Matimba male lions. Okay, now we are going to have to move. They are getting into some potentially tough country. And I hear you guys are getting some fantastic screenshots as those dogs showed us their reflection. Okay, hold on everyone. This is a tough little section. Fortunately, I know a little sneaky shortcut through here. This is actually the area where we saw Karula take down that dike alive. And if the elephants haven't added any extra obstacles, we'll be just dandy. There we go, back with them. There they go, down into the Moati River. They said we will be trying our best to stick with them. But this area across the river is pretty tough country. Holding on. Whoop-a! The way. Oh, at least they're being reasonably kind. Oh. Oh dear. Hold on. It looked like they saw something there. Ah, they stopped running. Thank goodness. Hi, guys. We've just come from there. Where are we going back that way for? Now, I'm not 100% sure where the Nkuhumas are. I know they're on, I think, Ledwood Road. Okay. Now, strange enough, one of the things I've seen wild dog kill the most, outside of the obvious impala and steenbokkies and things, is scrub hares. Now, I'm wondering if this one hasn't smelt a scrub hare somewhere around here. Oh, yeah, don't go that way, please. Where's the front dog? Do you see the third dog, Brian? Yeah. Ah, okay, good choice. Okay, we're just gonna go back around on the road. We're not gonna unnecessarily crash through there. Isn't this so exciting? What a great first day back. You see them, Brian? Right, there they are. So fast. Well, thank you, Valeria, who says if anyone can stay with the wild dogs, it's Brent. Don't tell Steph. I think Steph has minor heart attacks every time I start following wild dogs through the bush. Oh, whoopsie. Okay. So they're heading through along Inyala Road South, and it's quite a productive area for them to be hunting, because you've got a lot of these little mud wallows and water holes, so there's always a good chance you're going to get impala, kudu. But the other thing is, because you're right on the edge of the Inyala Road South river system, you could get inyala, you could get bushbuck, and some of the other species. So it's a good area for them to be hunting, and specifically at this time of the day. Now let's hope they keep going on the road. If they go off to the right, life becomes again quite challenging. I think they're going to keep parallel. So this is what we call coursing. So they just keep running through the bush till they get something and they'll be able to chase it and take it down. I'm just gonna go forward ahead of them for a little bit. I just wanna have a quick look. I'm sure they're gonna come through. I just wanna see if we can get up ahead and see if there's any potential prey species up ahead. And it doesn't look like it so far, but here they go, here they come, right at us. There they are. Hello, puppies. At the moment, the female definitely seems to be leading. That very distinctive wild dog smell. Here he goes. Okay, we're gonna keep going. Now I know the lions are around that way. Let's hope the dogs go that way. Around the corner. Oh, it's a wild dog. I can't believe there's no impala or inyala here today. I see that wonderful orange sky behind them as the sun sets. So again, I'm just going to go up ahead of them and wait at the next road junction. Remember, hashtag Safari Live, or questions at wildearth.tv if you've got any questions for us. But while we jump ahead to go see what's cracking, let's go back to Jamie and some kitty cats.
A very big kitty cat under very dramatic skies. Oh, and he's up and he's off. And I think he's actually thinking about calling. And I owe you all an apology. I told you I was rusty. This is definitely not tenure. I was fooled by the skin condition that this particular lion has, this particular male. Now, I haven't worked out exactly who it is. I haven't had a good opportunity to really sit and look, but it's definitely not Tenyor. Whoever he is on the move. My suspicion is that it's Nsugu, but that's... the bald patches on his skin had me fooled for a second. Right, off we go. Male lion on the move, wild dogs on the move. What an exciting afternoon to be back in the bush. And a storm gathering, Dave. I think you're wrong. I think it's going to rain. But you know what I'm like with weather predictions. I probably shouldn't even try. I might even be jinxing it. Our male lion stopping to mark his territory. Oh. And moving on his way to quarantine. This is going to be spectacular. With the sunset and the open area that is quarantine, this is going to be truly, truly beautiful. I'm going to hope that he's not going to lie down. I'm going to take a chance and try and get ahead of him so we've got him on the clearing. So we're just going to go round back onto the road. I think this should work. Sorry, just bear with me one moment. I've just got to update people on the game drive comms. Stations, for those of you interested, this mail lion is now on his way towards quarantine. Copy that, thank you. Okay, let's do this. Don't lie down. Well, I mean, you can lie down. Please do whatever you want. I'm not actually saying don't lie down. Just think it might be very nice if we could get ahead of him as he walks. I see you. Oh, it's going to be such... It is such a spectacular evening. The atmosphere. This is a proper summer bush evening. This is what we were missing the whole of last year. This build-up of heat and humidity, but it's in a nice way because you know that there's potential relief at the end of the day. The proper African summer. I'm hoping that might mean a proper African rainfall. Right next to the house that we live in, by the way. Where'd he go? I just saw him 2 seconds ago. Did he lie down? Oh, there he is. Yep, lay down. I suppose when your belly is that full, any walk is a bit of a mission. Here we go. Stopping to pant. And that is a very typical movement for a male lion, or any lion with a full belly. Up and walk a little bit, then stop and relax again. You can see he's very, very warm. I wonder where he's been hiding. And I wonder if there is a female in the vicinity. We're still missing one of the Nkuhumo lionesses. She's obviously not with him, because there's no way he would have left her. Isn't that stunning? And maybe if we are very, very lucky, we might even get a chance to hear him call. And Fran, thank you so much for sending that through. It is wonderful to be back. And as you said, wild dogs, a Birmingham boy that we don't often get to see, and even a storm on the horizon. It's definitely building. Feel it in the air. It's heavy, heavy. I'm hoping Dave is wrong. I can't describe this atmosphere to you unless you've been and you've visited Africa before. Perhaps you come from an area where there are heavy thunderstorms, but there's nothing quite like the atmosphere that builds before a storm. There's a certain smell, and it's as though the earth starts to exude its heat, giving up its heat. It gets very, very hot, almost oppressive, and everything goes dead still. There is not one breath of wind, and it seems as though the world is kind of holding its breath in anticipation before the storm breaks. I love this feeling, because when the storm does break, it is truly spectacular. And as a South African, I think one of the things I missed the most when I lived in the UK were the thunderstorms, a proper thunderstorm. And for the lions, of course, it means a good evening of hunting, if indeed they can be bothered. And I have to say, I'm not 100% sure that he is going to be doing any hunting anytime soon. I'm not sure what you think, but you never know. They are opportunistic, completely opportunistic animals. So good to be back. boy. What do you think? So yes, thank you all for your welcome back. I cannot tell you how happy I am to be here. Dave, it's good to be back.
Oh, it's good to have you.
Thank you. Suddenly, incredibly oppressive heat. Did you feel that change? Come on, Storm. We need you. And there's also something quite spectacular about watching lions in the rain as well. They always tend to be slightly more playful, too. Although I doubt he's going to be playing, but slightly more active, definitely. This drop in temperature, I think, comes as a massive relief to them. Marisha, I think so too. I see, I've been thinking it as well. I thought I'd made a mistake because his scar has healed up so nicely. But Marisha, I saw that half moon nick as well, out of the top right of his ear. And while that's actually half the reason why I've been so distracted, as I've been listing the various nicks and scratches of the various Birmingham boys, and Tenure does have a half moon out of his ear. And his mane is not full enough for it to be in Sugu, and it's not full enough for it to be Nena, the two older Birmingham boys. And he definitely, I mean, unless Mfumo did some incredible healing on his cheek while I was away, it's not him. I think it's Tenure. I've been desperately going through, running through the various nicks and scars of the Birmingham boys off the top of my head, but as I said, I'm a little bit rusty. I think it's Tenure. I need you to turn, mister. Would you oblige me? Or maybe, perhaps not. How would you feel about that? It would be very convenient if you would. I think that scar on his lip has just healed up so much that it's no longer visible, which is, of course, the danger of recognizing an animal by its scars. That's what happens. They heal, and they heal incredibly well. Hold on, he's seen something. I'm just going to switch my light off and change in his body language. What did you see, boy? Okay, he's relaxed a little bit again. Just that brief switch in the way that he was looking off into the distance. He's looking straight at the house that Brent and myself live in, at Inga's house, which is probably about 200 meters off to my right. I don't see anything. Sandra, you say you think that the only way that he will hunt is if a buffalo happened to just lie down next to him. I think that's a pretty valid assumption, Sandra. That's hilarious. We know just how incredibly fortunate the various predators have been during this drought. It's been such a time of plenty for them that he really doesn't need to bother himself too much. You never know, though. Predators always do strange things, strange and unexpected things. The Birmingham boys were, when they first entered onto the scene, from what I understand, were unbelievable and are unbelievable buffalo hunters. There was a time on Simbombili where they killed 8 different buffalo in one go, but that was a whole buffalo herd, and that was when all 5 of them were together. But 8 different buffalo carcasses in one night. They didn't eat them all in the end. And if I remember correctly, there were even lionesses scavenging off the leftovers while they could, very secretively. So who knows what's in this Birmingham boy's head. I doubt he's going to hunt, but I am hoping that he decides to reconnect with the rest of his... Oh yes, you could be a shampoo advert, mister. Look at that, a hair product line with the wind blowing through his mane. Definitely some kind of brand of hair care product, or perhaps a very good hair dryer. Beautiful. I am hoping he's going to roar. Here comes the wind, Dave. It's on its way. All of a sudden, remember I said it was completely still? Oh, the wind is coming. we might end up having to shorten the sunset safari. Or at least do a mad dash back to safety. Let's see how we go. We've got 45 minutes. I think we'll make it. But you never know. Okay. I'm tossing up what I want to do. I wanted to go on a little bit of a bumble, but I actually think I'm going to play the patience game and wait for him to call. While I do, Brent has been frantically trying to find the wild dogs. I don't think he's had any success, but let's go and hear it from him.
Oh, and they gave us the slip. But we did have such a great afternoon with them. We saw them get chased by buffalo. We saw them get chased by zebra. I lost them in a very steep little river system that we couldn't get through in the car. So by the time I came to this side, but I'm hoping they might have just gone towards Buffalo's Hook Dam. So that's what I'm going to do. I keep seeing wild dogs everywhere. But hopefully they have it. Their general direction was heading towards the Buffalo's Hook waterhole. So fingers crossed. And you never know, there could be a leopard lounging at the waterhole. Probably not, though. In New Zealand. Now, Aaron would like to know, are the wild dog closely related to the other, or the first most endangered canid in Africa, which is the Ethiopian wolf, or the Simian fox? Now, let's just hope there's a wild dog below us. There's not. We'll just wait here for a few minutes, see what happens. And while we discuss the Ethiopian wolf and the wild dog, hello, hippopotami. So, here's the hippo. Now, the Ethiopian wolf is far more closely related to a good old domestic dog. It's a canid, and it shares its sort of genetic lineage with wolves. And so it is a canis and not a licon. So it is more closely related to dogs and wolves than it is to the African wild dog. At least we had some rain while we were gone and greened up the place, put a bit of water about. Splendid. No wild dogs behind us, Brian?
No.
No? Okay, we'll carry on. Remember the hashtag SafariLive or questions at wildearth.tv if you'd like to be like Aaron in New Zealand and ask us a question while we're on the live drive. Now, I think it's going to be a very interesting couple of months coming up now. We are going to get some rain, but it's not predicted to be flooding, which is what you see in Brian. Nothing. Which is not necessarily a bad thing. So if we had massive rains this year, massive flooding, it actually would be quite bad for a lot of the topsoil. So if we have normal rains, that's good. The elephants have done a good job clearing out some areas, smashing up the trees. The termites have then got in there and adding nutrients to the soil. So hopefully the grass seeds that have been sitting dormant. If we get a good, nice, even rain this year, we should get a really nice grass platform, and that should keep our general game numbers up. So you don't really want flood after a drought, you just want nice even rains. Because otherwise, if you get too much rain too quickly, all that topsoil and those dormant grass seeds and stuff are often just washed away. And it can cause erosion and take a little bit longer for the bush to get better. Now of course, we are quite biased in how we want the bush to be. But the bush can be however it chooses. And that's one thing we've got to remember. Drought, flood, famine, feast are all part of the natural system. Ashley, hello, who's in the United Kingdom, is wondering, do I think animals can feel the change in pressure when the rains and things come? I would definitely think that they're probably far more aware of it than we are. Certain species in particular, you can, especially certain insects and frogs and reptiles, definitely able to pick up the barometric change, and they behave differently accordingly. Now, could be quite exciting to, we could get some frogs. I still think the frogs are probably not quite there yet. We need a little bit more rain. We need sort of, for the frogs to really sort of spark off, you need those little mud wallows like we've been following the dogs going past to get a little bit of vegetation growth there. So somewhere for them to hide. At the moment, a lot of the frog species be quite vulnerable. But what we're gonna do is we're gonna head down the straight road. And there we go, Buffalo's a cut line. To that area around the northwestern corner, around the entrance gate, and where that leopard was seen crossing this morning. It's very possible that leopard's been lying up in the heat of the day, and now as it's getting a bit darker, he or she might be on the move. So maybe we'll have some leopard luck in that area. Now, Brian, in my absence, has anyone seen a chameleon?
Yes.
No!
I've spotted one, yes.
Oh, darn it. Okay, so the chameleons are back. Okay. Oh, so, one, only one?
Two.
Two. Okay, well, hopefully we can add 3, 4, and 5 this evening. We'll have a good look for chameleons. As we go, I was thinking, as I looked at the one branch, I thought I saw a chameleon there. I was like, oh, I wonder if anyone spotted one. Oh, Quran, red crested, just look at that camouflage. There we go, all female red crested Quran. Oh, they are a stunning bird. Oh. And I heard you had a crazy sighting with three of them with Taylor this morning. Oh, magnificent colouring. Now, of course, they sleep on the ground, but they are very alert. I actually have seen a leopard catch one before. But it is quite difficult for a lot of animals to catch them. And we'll let her disappear, find her little spot to spend the night. Now, we're going to head up towards that northwestern corner looking for the leopard. Now, fingers crossed that that big burly Birmingham with Jamie decides to give you a show.
And we've definitely had a fantastic first afternoon back, and I'm hoping we can round it off with a spotted cat and perhaps a lion roar, which is what I think Brent has in mind, certainly what I have in mind. The moment, though, this lion doesn't seem like he's got anything on his mind except perhaps a jolly good snooze, except there is a herd of wildebeest. Now, you won't, I don't know that you'll be able to see them. Maybe you, oh, you will. Well done, Dave. There's a herd of wildebeest, or an impala, racing around. The male's a little bit confused by all that's going on in terms of hormones with the pregnant females. So they're chasing each other around. And I don't think they've realized that this lion is here. And they're going to slowly but surely start making their way in this direction, because of course this is where the waterhole is. And although he's full, as we spoke about earlier, there is always the chance that any predator is an opportunist. Human beings included, and even with a full belly, he will absolutely think about hunting something. And perhaps if the wildebeest came and lay down next to him, as we spoke about with the buffalo earlier, we could actually see some action. A male lion of his size is more than capable of taking on a wildebeest on his own. And of course, they've got this terrible reputation, male lions, that they don't do any of the work. Oh, hold on. Let's have a closer look. Before we go into that, let's have a closer look in case he moves. Ouch! One of those things, the day-to-day injuries of these poor animals. Their lives are incredibly rough and tumble. Now, that could have been from a hunt, or it could have been from a scrap with another lion. I don't know. It's impossible to tell. Not too deep, though, and he will be absolutely fine. We've seen what kind of injuries these animals can heal up from. I'd love to see him full more and see how his face is looking. Dave, when last did you see him with his hole in his face? It's been a while. I'd love to see him and see how that healing process is playing out. When I left, it was already well on its way to healing. Okay. I wonder what I was talking about was the unfair reputation that these male lions have, that they kind of are just lazy slobs and they let the females do all the work, which is completely unfair, of course. Yes, if the females hunt and kill something, absolutely they will take the lion's share, without bothering as to whether or not they've participated in the hunt at all. That being said, they are more than capable of hunting things themselves, and they do regularly. And, of course, they've still got the added energy expenditure of patrolling and marking a territory. And Donna Lee, you've raised a question that I've actually been thinking about as well, which is, why are the lions hunting and not scavenging off at the dead buffalo that are all around? Is it their prey drive? Yes, it is their prey drive, if the opportunity presents itself, which of course it has been, because essentially the Nkuhumas and some of the Birmingham boys have basically been moving in about a kilometre radius around the waterholes the entire time. And the buffalo have to come and drink, and therefore they have to encounter lions. So yes, I think the prey drive is very much a factor. As to why we haven't seen that many of them scavenging off the dead buffalo, I really don't know. I think it's just there's so much around that they actually... they're spoilt for choice, essentially. Why that buffalo at Buffalsook Dam hasn't been fed upon? It didn't even have vultures on it when I drove past earlier. It's just a massive dead buffalo with nothing feeding off it. And the only thing I can think of is, A, they haven't found it, so they haven't encountered it, or B, there's just so much to choose from. But you raise a very, very good point. Just before I went on leave, in fact, it was my last drive before I went on leave, we were doing rehearsals, and I'd found a dead buffalo on Gowrie Main. And the hyenas, and it was probably our hyena clan, although I don't know for certain, the hyenas had clearly been there. There were tracks absolutely everywhere around this thing, and it had kind of been fed upon, but they weren't there. They'd just left. This carcass still had half of its meat still on it, and they just left. They couldn't be bothered to be, I don't know if it was maybe fear of the lions, perhaps, that kept them from hanging around for too long. But it is absolutely fascinating to watch. As hard as it is for us with this drought and the way that it's impacted the animals, it has been fascinating to learn about the way that the animals behave and who benefits and who obviously loses out in the way that this all works. We predicted that the predators were going to have an incredible time. The animal, of course, that would have had the hardest, one of the animals that has had the hardest time of things is the hippo. Apparently he is out of the water grazing. Because I don't think this lion's going to go too far, I might go and have a quick look at the hippo before we lose too much light. We could go and have a look at the hippo and then come back to the lion. Apparently he's out and about. Let's go and have a look at him, because we don't always get presented with the opportunity to have a hippo out of water. And I can't see him from... nearly broke my microphone there. I can't see him from where we are, so let's go and have a look. Don't move too far. You can move, but don't move too far, please. It's always such a toss-up when I know that there's wildebeest coming down the side, but I really don't think he's going to go after them. He could not look more relaxed if he tried. So let's go and have a look at the hippo. I'm not sure whether any of you have seen the pictures talking about hippos and the struggle that they've faced. Obviously, the weaker they get, the easier a target they become for things like lions. And there are some incredible pictures circulating from the Kruger National Park of a lion hunt, lions hunting a hippo. And the hippo, and it just goes to show just how careful it's... the pictures are amazing, but it is a really important warning as to just how careful one needs to be in an area like this with wild animals. The hippo turns around and sinks its jaws into a Land Rover. I think it's a Land Rover. Into somebody's private vehicle. One of the tourist vehicles. And it just gives you a really good idea, or really good perspective, of just how massive these creatures are. Because you can see his jaws have covered right onto the front part of the vehicle. Dave, have you seen those pictures? It's incredible. I mean, shame. This poor hippo is obviously terrified, and it's a good lesson for the people concerned. It could have gone... probably wouldn't have gone too bad, but it could have potentially been very dangerous for them. But I'm sure those of you, perhaps those of you who have seen that article or seen those pictures before, maybe you can post a link on some of the forums so that some of our other viewers who haven't perhaps seen it can have a look. It really is a very interesting perspective as to just how massive these creatures are and how we must never ever take them for granted. Shame, poor hippo. I don't know what the end result was. I think the end result was that the lions did actually catch and kill the hippo. There he is. And we're always, personally, I myself am quite wary, and at this time of year with the drought and in these conditions, are very, very careful when approaching an animal like a hippo, particularly one out of water. And just because they are unpredictable and they're stressed. And I don't want to add to his stress levels. So we're going to give him plenty of room. See how he reacts. Hello, my boy. Now, Hunter, this gives us actually a brilliant opportunity to answer your question. Let me just get this light stable. You want to know how you tell if it's a boy or a girl hippo. Oh, shame. You can see he's also got a bad limp. We definitely don't want to get too close to this. Now, if we can zoom in a little bit between his back legs, you're looking at the only real way to tell. And in fact, Hunter, from what I can see in the gloom, this might actually not be a boy. This could actually be a female. So the only way to tell, because the males have internal testicles, like elephants, so one of the only ways to tell is to look between their legs and look for the penis sheath that hangs between them. And it's hard, oh, it's so hard in this gloomy light. I can't really see properly. My suspicion would have been that it was a male, just the fact that it was alone. You can also look at the shape of their head. The males tend to have slightly squarer, broader heads, but that's a risky... it's a risky way of approaching things because, of course, you get young males, you get older females. The distinction isn't always that clear. Now, if we have a look from a slightly different perspective, this must be, I'm sure this is a male. I just can't see the penis sheath properly. But have a look at the shape of his head and the broadness of it. One of the more difficult animals to tell the difference between a male and a female. But how cool is it that we've got these two different perspectives? Chomping away, using that incredibly broad lip to essentially mow the lawn. And there you go, looking at him from behind as he shuffles around. And it's very, very clear, and I'm sure Steph has showed you the signs of the hippo feeding. Oh, Brent's got one of the little nocturnal creatures. Let's have a look.
It's a baby bush baby. There were actually three of them looking out, and this is the bravest of them. So it's, well, not quite a baby, it's a youngster, a teenager. Look at that, isn't that just the cutest thing? Now, when I first spotted this is a new hole, there were six sets of eyes, and I thought, well, that looks quite strange. So this is a new hole, I didn't know about this one. Oh, where are you going? Hopefully you're coming back with a sibling or two. Just waking up now. And they are just too sweet. Those massive eyes designed for spotting things at night. Great insectivores. So they're great hunters. They also do eat certain plant species, fruits, but the South African galago, or lesser bush baby, which is this little guy, is a great lover of insects. So summer's here, happy days for the bush babies. Come on, I'm waiting for the next one to sort of force its head out. Leopard right here. Oh, bush baby, there's a leopard calling on Gallagher's shortcut. Okay. Bye, little guy. Oh, there's another one. There's two, they're playing. Oh, torn between leopard and bush babies. Torn. Well, they've popped back down. Okay, let's go see if we can find that leopard. Isn't that awesome? I must remember this little spot. It's a good one. Wouldn't that just be too wonderful to find a leopard as well, Brian? You know, just all the animals all the time. Killer bees are back. Okay, let's go. It sounded like on Gallagher's shortcut, so it could be Tingana. We've got leopard audio. It sounds like on Gallagher's shortcut. About halfway between Buffalo's Hook and Vuyatel Axis. So I'm pretty sure what that leopard calling is definitely the one that they saw crossing this morning. Exciting times. So while we try catch up to where we thought we heard that leopard, let's go back to another big cat with Jamie.
How exciting would it be if we managed to get a leopard as well? And we're actually going to try and help Brent out while we sit with this flat male lion, who so far doesn't show any signs of making any sounds. We're actually close enough that we could probably hear the leopard calling that Brent has heard. So we're going to try and keep listening as we sit here and just wait and see if we can help him at least figure out exactly where that sound came from. Oh, what an absolute pleasure. I mean, Brent and myself didn't go far. We were in Hoedspruit for the entirety of our leave, but there's nothing quite like being properly in the bush. We did hear lions occasionally, and hyenas, and leopard, but it's not quite the same as living in a reserve with them. He doesn't look like he's doing anything, hey, mister? Thoroughly content. Now, for our newer viewers, for those of you who perhaps have just jumped on board for the last few shows, you'll notice that we're very, very careful in our approach to lighting up animals. Now, if this were a diurnal animal, like those wildebeest, for example, that were behind me, I would not be using a spotlight in any way. But for nocturnal predators and nocturnal creatures, like the bush baby you saw with Brent, perhaps like the leopard you're going to see with Brent, see how optimistic that was, and with our lion, the reflective membrane of behind their eyes is so incredibly potent and adapted towards helping them see in the dark that we don't in any way affect them by shining spotlights on them. That being said, it's really important that we do it incredibly carefully and ethically. What you'll notice is I'm basically bouncing the spotlight off the ground. So I'm not shining it straight into his face. I could, but that's not really polite. In terms of how we deal with the animals. So we try and avoid shining it directly at them, and what we'll do is we'll use the ground to bounce the light back up and just illuminate the lion as much as possible. Now that's the sort of thing that we'll do when we're following them behind. Then of course if he were to start hunting, which I have to confess at the moment seems relatively unlikely, but never say never, but if he were to start hunting, we would immediately turn off our spotlight. And that, of course, is where the joy of infrared comes in. You can see he's listening still. Whilst he does look fast asleep, he's constantly alert and listening. It is him. You see, it is him. There you can see the scar on his lip. It's just healed up so incredibly well that it was difficult to see at first. I really thought I was going crazy. I thought I was so rusty when I said it was tenure and then I couldn't see the scar. But I'm feeling... a lot more comfortable in my initial assessment that it was still correct. I had a moment of serious confusion there. It's a problem with being away for too long. But you can see he is still alert, still listening, his ears still working. Never fails to astound me the speed with which an animal like this can go from fast asleep, or looking like it's fast asleep, to up and moving. And we've seen it in so many different circumstances, from lions hunting to leopards running away from something or running towards a threat with Karula or Tundi, for example, in the baboons. Their senses are so much more refined than ours, or at least their sense of hearing and smell. Not their sight. Our sight is better, except at night. But we've spoken about this before, but I would love to be able to climb inside an animal's head for the day. I don't know how to describe exactly what I mean, but perhaps you'll understand. Be able to sort of experience the world as the animals do. Oh, look at that. You've got quite an impressive mane stretching down to your chest, mister. Amazing how much they've fulled out. But yes, to be able to experience the way that they experience the world, I think would be absolutely fascinating. To be in a lion's head and to be able to smell like they can smell and hear the way they hear. Don't you think it would be absolutely incredible? It would be difficult to choose, though, which animal to experience the mind of. Perhaps one day. It's amazing how much more and more we are learning about these animals and how much our understanding is deepening. He's not too bothered, though. I'm quite happy to pant away. You know, you might even find, going back to the conversation about the buffalo, and that he might even find he was scavenging off a buffalo carcass. There's only so much that we see of these animals. The Nkuhumas are a different story. We spend a great portion of their lives with them and experience what they are up to and what they're doing. But for the male lions, I don't know. I don't know when last you saw Tino. And apparently you have been seeing him relatively regularly, which is the same as when I left as well. Tinio and Mfumo, the two of them together in this particular area. I wonder if Mfumo is with the youngest Nkuhuma female. I don't know. It's supposition. It's guesswork. I'm still sort of re-finding my feet back in the bush, working out where everybody is and where all the animals are. Come on, mister. Well, perhaps if he doesn't roar for us tonight, perhaps those of you watching the dam camera will get to be treated to the sound effects. I'm hoping if he does decide to roar tonight, he won't go too far away, because my bed's probably about 250 meters away. It'd be nice to hear that on my first night back. Now, speaking of the sounds of the bush, Brent, of course, was trying to track down that leopard. Let's see how his search is going.
So we sat and listened, we didn't hear anything, but from my guess, sorry, I'm going to blind the poor impala, my guess is heading towards the Galago Pan, so that's what we're going to go do. Probably stand by there and wait for a little bit, hoping he's going to pop out. Come on, Tinganana. On a positive note, if we don't find him, we definitely got something to look for in the sunrise safari. So we're getting quite close to the waterhole now. He likes to take a route through the middle of this block here. When I say block, of course, I don't mean the concrete blanket. A block is a big patch of bush with no roads in it. And this is a particularly thick one. So we didn't try a venture in the dark into it. We tried to second guess rather where that leopard's going to pop up. Hunter. Well, Hunter is wondering how fast can a leopard run? Well, at its top speed, Hunter does 24 meters per second, which is just over 90 kilometers an hour. But it can't do it for very long. So normally they do those bursts for less than 20 meters. But it is a very fast animal when it wants to be. Now, Juma Dam Cam peeps, keep a lookout, because he might not come to Gallagher. Who knows, he might pop up at the Juma Dam. I'm just going to sit here and listen for a second or two. Maybe the African night is broken with the rasping call of a male leopard. Answer? Maybe not. But it's a very good chance he's going to pop up here. He could easily go the other way towards the Juma Dam. And so good chance for those of you who watch the dam cam. Keep an eye out. I would have said when we heard him calling last, he was in this area just up here. In that dark patch there that Brian's showing you. In the black. You can just make out the horizon. Now, it's a good hunting night for leopards. There's a bit of a breeze, but it's this cloud cover that is going to make it a bit easier for them to hunt. Hi, Robin. Now, Robin B is wondering, will a male leopard scent mark on a regular route so you can basically work out where he's going? Sometimes. Sometimes they do like to take a specific route. Other times they just scent mark as they go. Generally, when there's a lot of scent marking, it's generally on a boundary with another male leopard. And from our point of view, Tingana's next boundary is actually quite far from here. It's up towards the Buffleshoek boundary. And his next boundary is very far from here, towards Anderson and along the drainage system in Arethusa. Come on, break the silence. Oh, get spotted by an impala. We'll take just as much as we'll take a... I'll give it another 30 seconds. Quite a quiet night. You can just hear one confused starling. I've been sitting in the dark like this, trying to listen for leopards or lions at times, and all of a sudden they sort of just appear out of the darkness next to you. Whoops. And Tingana's done that to me right here. Just do a quick glance with the spotlight. I think the route he might come through is literally through here. Okay, well, let's move back up towards Gallagher Shortcut. Maybe. He's changing his route for the evening. So while we keep searching for the glorious male leopard known as Tingana, let's go to one of the glorious Birmingham boys.
From the search for one big cat to an established big cat sighting, our Birmingham boy is still doing a very, very good impression of being fast asleep. He's not asleep, though. Every now and again, he does glance up, so he's not fast asleep. He's sort of doing what lions do best, which is catnapping. But I don't think he's really properly sleeping at all. It would be amazing to hear them vocalize, or hear him at least vocalize properly. And then if he does start to call, then perhaps even we'll get an idea of where the other Birmingham boys are. I have heard rumors, but they haven't, before we go too far into this, I have heard rumors, but I don't know exactly how confirmed they actually are. Goodness, summer insects coming back. But I've heard rumors of Junior being around Simbombili area, which would be absolutely incredible. Junior, of course, for our new viewers, is a lion, a young male lion that was with the was part of the Nkuhuma pride. He was the offspring of the Nkuhuma females. And he did what male lions do when they reach sexual maturity, which is move off and disperse. And he's been around every now and again. He's been around Manuleti, Buffleshoek area. He's managed to form a coalition with another young male lion, and it's not yet confirmed which particular male lion that he has joined up with. But they have been seeing two young male lions, one slightly older, roughly Junior's age, and one slightly younger, roughly his coalition buddy's age, around Simbombili. Can you imagine if we had a chance to actually see Junior? It's not confirmed, though, Before we get too excited, I don't think, or at least it wasn't when I was last chatting to some of the other guides, I don't think that they've confirmed exactly which male lions, and there are many young male lions moving about an area at any one point in time, and it's impossible to keep track of them. Because a male lion, when he disperses away from his natal range, can move hundreds of kilometers at a time to search for a gap in territory. Either way, it would be very, very interesting. And I know that we'll be keeping a close eye and ear out for any signs of this particular pair showing any signs of moving towards Juma. That would be very exciting. He would have to be careful, though, of course, especially with the Birmingham boys in this area. Okay, thank you so much. Speaking of sort of getting an idea of where the other Birmingham boys are, Jean sent through an answer. Thank you, Jean. Much appreciated. You said apparently the last time we saw him four more was when he was mating with a Styx lioness. So presumably more towards the east, unless the Styx had moved a little bit, but probably more towards the east, more towards Cheetah Plains side. And that apparently was around Sunday. So he could well still be occupied with that particular pastime, which would explain his absence from Juma. It has been interesting, and of course it's nothing set in stone, but it has been interesting watching the dynamics of the Birmingham boys unfold. And the way in which, and that it could change completely from one year to the next as they settle into being the dominant males, but the way that Mfumo and Tinio always have seemed to be together, occasionally with Nena, the one of the sort of older Birmingham boys. He's been with them occasionally, and with Nsugu every now and again. But Mfumo and Tinio seem to be the ones that spend the most time together. Or perhaps it's just because we've spent the most time with them. But certainly over recent months on Juma with the Nkuhumas, a lot of the Birmingham boy sightings have been Tinio and Mfumo. Just listening for one second, I can hear guinea fowl. There's always a chance that Tingana's decided to come down towards the Juma Pan. They're not alarm calling frantically enough, though. So the sound I'm listening to is the sound of a bird, a guinea fowl, and they are calling off towards the waterhole. Just hear them in the background past the Skopsal. I'm going to keep listening in case it does sound like they might be alarm calling at a leopard. In the meantime, let's go over to the man who is searching for said leopard.
He is evading us. But don't worry, we haven't given up. I decided to have a quick look across quarantine to make sure my emergency alarm system was in... What was that, Brian? Scrub here. No, don't worry. That our alarm system is in place, and it definitely is. If that leopard pops up anywhere near here, there is a plethora of wildlife. Should we try a bit of infrared, show you how many animals there are? I'm going to give it a go. Okay, we're going to do this now. So we're going to see how many... So there's probably, in my estimate, there's probably over 150 impala. There's zebra, there's wildebeest, there's waterbuck, and I almost thought I saw some buffalo in the distance as I flashed over quickly. All moving out into the open on this dark night, giving them that slightly better chance at seeing potential predators come their way. So, I mean, it is incredible. We're going to do a little loop here now, and so we've got the infrared all set up. Ooh, spider webs everywhere. And just show you. Oh, apparently the switch is not working. Yeah, let me just do this quickly. I can't really see. But I mean, literally at 180 degrees, there's just everything. If I go very quick, you just see animals all the way back. But let's, sorry about that, Brian. Let's just keep going a little bit. who knows? We're still searching for a chameleon, of course. Quite sad that there Brian saw one without me, but I'll survive. And it is so nice to have all this greenery again. We haven't had any greenery, and it looks like Brian might have fixed something up. There's still animals everywhere. Now, of course, I'm hoping Queen Karula comes back for a little visit, and hopefully tomorrow. Love to see old Hassana and Shongira, see how much they've grown in the last 20 days or so. Oh, here we go. Now, I can see where Jamie is with the male lion down there, close to Inga's house where we live. Pop that up in the sky, some impala in the road. God, just amazing how many animals are here with this green flush we've got at the moment. It is literally incredible. The amount of general game is fantastic. Now, of course, when you've got high numbers of general game, you've got high numbers of predators. Now, I did see some buffalo. Oh, Brian's got it. Let's see, Brian thinks we've got it. Oops, no, not that, that's off. Okay, there we go. So we can start trying to show you some of the stuff in the dark now. There we go. So let's take that one off. Let's get a bit closer. We'll have to be a lot closer, apparently. There's a wildebeest in infrared. There's some wildebeest. There's some buffalo coming up in infrared. There we go. So some buffalo. And as I said, we're just around the corner. There's probably 200 plus impala. And we might get a glimpse of them in there. And we can see some more wildebeest in the right at the edge of the light there. This is incredible how many animals are out on quarantine this evening. So we're just going to go around the next corner to where all the impala are stationed. And hopefully I don't crash because I can't see where I'm going. Driving in the dark here. Oh, there we go. Let's get to them. So from the killer bees, it's been absolutely fantastic. I'm sure I look quite scary. Do I look scary, Brian?
You look scary.
I look scary. But here we go. Here the impala. Enough of me looking like an idiot. There's the edge of the impala here. So it must be 150 to 200 impala spread around quarantine this evening. So, and there's some waterbuck as well there. So just so many different species. But from Brian and myself, it's been great having you with us. And there comes an infrared thumb. And we look forward to being with you on the Sunrise Safari bright and early. It's great to be back. Thanks very much for all the congratulations. But back to the male lion for the last little bit of the show. To you too, wildebeest.
And really, I cannot think of a better way to spend one's first afternoon back in the bush than with some of Africa's most iconic predators. And what a truly special afternoon it has been. And whilst Etinyo shows no sound of giving us any roars or any kind of a show, and indeed really doesn't seem like he's going to be up to terribly much anytime soon, it has been an absolute pleasure to reunite with them once again. I'm looking forward to this evening, going to bed hopefully with the sounds of lions roaring, but keep an eye on the Juma Dam camera, because who knows, the leopard that Brent has been looking for might well pop out to have a drink there. You might hear the lions calling. In fact, I think there's a very good chance that you could hear the lions calling at some point tonight. All in all, spectacular things to look forward to, and then of course with eager anticipation, we look forward to tomorrow morning's sunrise safari, to find out what has unfolded during the night. I'm so looking forward to just bumbling out and about and maybe going to Cheetah Plains, maybe to Arethusa. Lots of things to look forward to. But this is a perfect way to be welcomed back into the bush. Thank you, mister. Very much appreciated. With your very full belly. And so, on that note, it is time for us to say goodbye. We've reached the end of the Sunset Safari and what's felt like a flash. So, a big thank you to David for his fantastic camera work, as always, and his wonderful company. It's nice to be back, Dave, as well as to... I think it's Kirsty and Lou in Final Control. It is Kirsty and Lou. And most importantly, a big thank you to all of you joining us from across the world, sending through your questions and your comments. And thank you again for all of your support and your incredible congratulations and welcome back. I'll catch up with you on the Sunrise Safari. Until then, bye-bye and have a wonderful time wherever you happen to be.